Hey, good morning. This is Richard Sachs, host of Lost Arts Radio, and I'm with you this morning for this version of our, this edition, I should say, of our question and answer show on June 4th, Saturday morning, 2016. Hope you're doing really well and have some things to share with you. And we have Doug Diamond, producing, engineering the show of diamonddiscaudio.com. Check out his website when you get a chance. See what he's doing a lot of the rest of the time. And as well as his other activities on geoengineering sites and helping people with all kinds of really exceptionally positive projects. And what we're doing here is personalizing and sharing some of the information that we put out on our regular Sunday night show. And that show, as hopefully you are aware, is Sundays, that's like tomorrow and every week, at 6 o'clock p.m. Pacific time, 9 o'clock Eastern. And the nice thing about that show is there we've had, from the very first show, it was really amazing, before anybody knew we were even around, we've had world-class guests, educational guests about all aspects of health and healing, and almost everything relates to health. And so there's a wide range of super interesting subjects covered on that show. We hope that you can be with us either tomorrow night or hear it as an archive sometime if you get a chance. The show is at the same place as this one on blogtalkradio.com/lostartsradio. And this question and answer show, as long as we keep it going, will be 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturdays, 11 o'clock Eastern. You can also see the archives on YouTube and Mixcloud, iTunes, places like that. So what to talk about today? I have some ideas I wanted to share with you. And you know, when we first started doing the radio show, I had been really keeping my health research and exploration into health and life and consciousness issues, which are all connected, very quiet since 1965 or so, when I actually really got started in this exploration work, due to my own serious health problems at the time. That's often the motivation for people that get into exploring holistic health, because they get desperate enough to be willing to change some things and look outside the usual box and look for some real education. And they realize that education may be more than just memorizing the things that were taught in government-sponsored schools, even the private schools. Now, as they start to take more government money, masquerading as free money, just take this nice free money, no problem. And it comes with strings attached. And that corrupts education completely, which is the whole purpose of the government being in control of education, even though it's told to you that it's to make it all uniformly wonderful. It's not exactly to do that. It's something quite opposite. And just like the government health system is, it is wonderful in the sense that, as Doug experienced recently, and all of us through him, that they can put people back together in accidents and traumas and certain genetic, birth defects, that congenital birth defects that you're born with that have to be surgically corrected. They can do wonderful things with those. But as far as health is concerned, doctors are taught the exact opposite of the right information, and they trustingly, in most cases, convey that to us. And then we trustingly believe it. But eventually, when things get bad enough and the results of the wrong approach start, you know, building up and we really get in trouble, then sometimes we get motivated to look beyond that. And that's basically what happened to me. I was as unconscious as anybody for a lot of my life, and certainly up to the mid-60s, I was completely oblivious to most of what's going on. And then things got really tough for me, and I had to make some decisions, and the medical system was going to kill me with the cutting-edge science that they were employing, and I decided to ditch it at that time, which is more than 50 years ago now, and decide if I was going to die, fine, but I was going to die, you know, following what I found out to be the truth and not just trusting people to drug me and cut me up in pieces as the, you know, most wonderful medicine. So anyway, I kept on that search for decades and decades and was going to be very quiet, because the more I learned, the more I realized how far outside of the normal paradigm of thought I was getting. And I'd have just about every industry, not just the medical industry, but all the others I was finding out were connected. And all the people who were holding on to their group or their label or their identity or their belief system at all costs and absolutely didn't want to hear anything that questioned whatever it was they believed, because that would threaten their whole view of reality. And I had no desire to do that, because everybody's totally free and should always be free to follow exactly what feels right to each person, as long as they don't hurt anybody else. So I was just going to be quiet and disappear forever for the rest of my life. And then I got asked to do a radio show and was fortunate to help Dane Wigington and Russ Tanner with the Geoengineering Watch radio show at the time. Did that for, I think, about 8 months or so. And then again, was going to try to disappear and was asked to do a health radio show, which eventually became Lost Arts Radio. So I thought, all right, well, apparently I'm not supposed to be invisible anymore. But I still kept, you know, we had such great guests. I really just wanted to step out of the light and behind them and kind of hide behind the great guests that we had and not really talk about what I'd been doing for the last many years. And gradually I realized that even though we have wonderful guests on our show and we need to really learn from them in as deeply as we can, that I needed to share some of what I had done as well, because maybe it would be something that would trigger a realization on your part, encourage you to go beyond what other people consider acceptable for you to do and be true to yourself. I think that was just about the most important mistake, and I've made so many mistakes in my life, but that was maybe the most important one. Is to, and this started in elementary school as a little kid. I was trying to please other people, you know, parents and teachers and other kids and people that I wanted to like me and think that I was acceptable. I decided to please, I mean, it wasn't an official conscious decision, but I kind of just gradually fell into it. I wanted to please them instead of being true to myself. And I'm suggesting this is one of the most important mistakes that we all make in our own life. And part of the reason we do, excuse me, is that we're taught that there's two ways to be. You can be selfish, which is bad, and then you're a bad person. Or you can be selfless, give up everything you want, realize that your own desires are evil, or at least misinformed. And just give up what you want for the sake of serving others. A lot of philosophies and religions push that, and many times it's because they don't understand what's really behind it. And what's behind it, there are many clues to why that's wrong. And there's one that I wanted to talk about more today if we get a chance, and that is, you've heard it said, attributed to Jesus, actually, that you're supposed to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, wait a minute. I thought if you're supposed to be selfless, then that means you're supposed to love your neighbor instead of yourself. But that's not how it is. And in fact, if you want to love your neighbor as yourself, there's a trick to that. And it means you have to love yourself. Otherwise, really, it turns out you can only love your neighbor as in direct proportion to how you love yourself. And I totally didn't get that for decades. I was personally told about that. I was explained how it works. I mean, where I'm coming from here is I'm probably the densest person among everybody that I've ever run into so far, and I'm not saying that to claim some kind of a special award as the number one densest person, but I really was trying to get that, apparently. And so whatever I'm sharing with you is a result of having tried as hard as I could to do everything the wrong way, you know, with health and everything else for as long as possible, and finally realizing what was wrong with each thing and coming to certain lessons the hardest way that I could possibly do it. Lots of battle scars, lots of, you know, I've paid really heavily for the mistakes I've done. Many other people around me have had a bad time because of the mistakes I've made, and I'm really regretful of that. And part of what I'm doing now is trying to make up in some small, tiny measure for all of the really stupid stuff that I've done in my life. But anyway, this is not about me at all, this show. It's about you. That's why I'm kind of hoping that you'll listen to it. And what that means that it's about you is that, you know, I'm already on the, you know, fully involved in what I'm doing. I want to encourage you to realize your own incredible brilliance, the fact that you're not limited in the ways that you think you are, and that you can accomplish just about anything one way or the other, that it will come to you, provided there's a couple of requirements. The primary one being that you have to stop blocking it by your own unconscious beliefs that you can't do it. And there's really a lot to that. So I'm going to start saying more, you know, and anything that that I say that doesn't resonate, as they say, with what you feel, just discard it. You know, that's a nice thing about freedom. You get to think and experience and believe whatever it is you want that feels right to you, not to somebody else. And so you just take the things that are useful from what other people offer and put them through your own filtering system and what feels like something that will help you or that will expand your awareness or what you can do in your life. Use it, you know, in your own way, not in their way, because you're totally unique. And so I'm just going to be offering a bunch of things as far as ideas and experiences go. And then if you find that any of them are useful, explore them, use them, find out if they're true, throw them away if they're not for you. And just relax and feel free to find out what your incredible real potential in every area really is. And I would suggest that it's way beyond what you think it is right now in any area. And it's not talking about a philosophy, not talking about a belief system. You know, I'm much more interested in reality than in beliefs. So anyway, that's just kind of a little disclaimer that I'm not giving medical advice or anything like that. That's not legal. And besides, I don't want to anyway. I have no interest in that. There's plenty of doctors and other people you can go to for medical advice. Lots of drugs, all kinds of drugs, surgery, having organs removed when the drugs do too much damage, and all kinds of radiation and cutting edge science things you can get from them. All I'm doing is sharing some personal insight and experience and talking with you, which at this point is still considered legal in this country, at least for the moment. So let's see what we can do with that. And again, you know, I said it's about you. It's also about using your time. And there's not some kind of a special time to wait for where you really start doing what you want and really start paying attention, really start learning, working on yourself, doing resolutions next New Year's or whatever. It's all right now. And the immediate present is absolutely as special as any moment in time that's ever existed in all of history or that ever will exist right now. And if you wait to do what you want to do, you're going to keep waiting. So it doesn't mean that physically you can do absolutely everything right now, because you have circumstances that have resulted from your own actions in the past, not from somebody else. It looks like it happens from circumstances and somebody else, but we may get into it a little bit later. The reality behind that is that we create all of our own circumstances, every single one of them. And we also set up all of the interactions that we have with other people. It's all us. Now, I really didn't like that. I didn't even like hearing about it. It would make me angry in the past. And I thought, oh, that's ridiculous. You know, all these terrible people are doing all this stuff. If it wasn't for them, my life would be great. And it seems counterintuitive in a way to think that we are responsible for everything out there. Because logically, if you have limited vision, as almost, you know, virtually all of us do, you say, well, the chemtrail pilot is spraying the chemtrails, which is obviously true, but there's something way, way deeper underneath it. And if I eventually get to how I can explain that, what I mean by it, I will do it. But I'm going to kind of gradually get to that. The other thing is that when people come up and interact with you out of apparently nowhere, it's obviously them, right? You have nothing to do with it. No, that's not really what's going on. And what I'm going to try to get to here, and I don't know that I can, because language is really inadequate to cover the things that I want to talk about, which is quite a challenge because we're talking about things that can't be talked about, but have to just do our best. And, you know, sometimes you get clues about what's really going on by what is going on the surface that you see that's obvious. And I want to encourage all of you that have an interest in learning to be, you know, what used to be acknowledged as real scientists. And that means it doesn't have anything to do with what university that you got your 5 PhDs from. It doesn't have anything to do with your Nobel Prize. There are people who've gotten Nobel Prizes that have interesting backgrounds, not necessarily positive. And there are people with PhDs and multiple PhDs working on destroying the world as fast as they can. So that's obviously not the criterion of somebody who's really going to be in touch with what's real. A real scientist knows how to pay attention and how to observe what's going on, not just around them, but inside them. I'd say 99% of the PowerPoint from where you can change the world is absolutely internal. And it doesn't mean stop getting your petition signed for stopping GMOs or getting rid of nuclear power or making everybody aware that chemtrails are destroying the biosphere, which they are. Doesn't mean to take anything away from that. It means that if you want that to have more effect, you're going to have to work on yourself. If you ignore that, whatever the wonderful cause is that you're working on is going to gradually become a place of fighting and contention and hatred and condemnation and factions wanting to kill each other. All this ridiculous stuff. And that's far, far away from what's real. Because as all the philosophies and religions and, you know, just individual seekers have eventually found out over all of history, the reality is not about disharmony. It's the opposite. It's about something that's way beyond words and is, you know, really inadequately referred to as unlimited love, or light, or consciousness, or things like that, which don't begin to tell the story. So if you want your cause, whatever it is, to be infused with that energy and to have some amazing positive results way beyond what you imagine, then I recommend looking for that PowerPoint 100% inside yourself. And start understanding what happens to you as projected from internally. And that gets into some quantum physics ideas and way beyond, but it's actually true. So the more you can start monitoring yourself, as we've talked about before, starting with the idea, what am I thinking? Usually it's a judgment of somebody else or some circumstance or, feeling bad about something that's happening, or sometimes feeling really excited about something that's happening. But if you're not conscious and monitoring how you feel and how you think. The idea of progressing in your awareness is just a fantasy. Because your awareness comes from you. It doesn't come from outside events. You can be aware of them, but the quality of your awareness is generated internally. And you have to start that by becoming aware of how you, what you're thinking and what you're feeling. And wherever you are and whatever you're doing, the time to do that is in that immediate present moment, not some other time. Not on New Year's, unless it happens to be New Year's when you're thinking about it. And not not tonight or tomorrow, because you can do it while you're doing everything else. And, you know, I realize it sounds kind of funny. I should be talking about, well, should you be vegan or should you be vegetarian? Should you go on a 100% raw meat diet? But those are the easy part, figuring that out. The hard part is once you figure it out, doing it. And what stops you from doing it and doing these things that will heal your body are psychological and consciousness blocks. And if you don't get rid of that, then you're only going to go up to a certain point and then stop. And I would like you to just be able to keep going up to levels that are not imaginable right now. So it comes down to education. And by the way, before I forget, I want to mention that tomorrow night on our regular show, I'm sorry, I'm not really good at, Doug said, haha, you said 100% raw meat diet, I meant it. That was not a slip. And the reason I said that is there are people who actually believe that that's what you should do, is eat raw meat. And I know this is a little diversion, but Doug, that's an excellent point. And what I want to say about it is, and of course, your pets aren't going to want you to hear this because they're, I had to tell you this, but they're made out of meat and so are you. But I mean, physically anyway, but real carnivores, which humans are not, and I can back that up and so can other people, but real, some people think maybe they should be carnivores, but real carnivores have some characteristics. One of them, of course, is the short gut. One is the teeth made for ripping apart the bodies of their prey and holding on to them as they try to get away. The other is a psychology that enjoys the suffering of their prey and gets all excited about it. And that really makes them have a good appetite to see the prey animal screaming and dying. That's just super exciting. Normal humans do not have that psychology, okay? If you do, you have some other issues to work on. There are members of the elite, so-called elite rulers of the world that actually do have those characteristics, but it's not normal even for them. They're just seriously in trouble. But what I wanted to say about it is that real carnivores, in addition to having those characteristics, they all eat their meat raw. Meat in quotes. It's other animals, okay? They all eat other animals raw while they're still dying, mostly. And there are a couple of exceptions like vultures and maybe hyenas and animals that have like incredible stomach acid to take care of digestion of very old dead bodies. But most of the carnivores, most of the natural carnivores, they all eat 100% raw meat diet, which is why I mentioned that. And it's good that Doug got me to clarify, because some of you might have thought I meant 100%, you know, raw vegetarian diet or something. No, I meant raw meat. And there are people, I forget what it's called, it's like a branch of paleo, and they believe that you should eat raw meat because well, they're right in one sense. The only healthy way to eat meat is raw and just killed or just dying. Okay, but you also have to have a short gut, which we don't, and your body has to be completely different. The remember that we talked about making compost in your gut every day, all day. You're all gardeners. You're all making compost. And where you're making it is in your intestinal tract. And you're throwing scraps of food on it that get chewed up by your teeth, hopefully. And also a lot of carnivores don't do that, by the way. They just swallow big chunks of it. And their stomach acid takes care of the rest. They can dissolve bones and everything. They're really different than us, okay? We're not supposed to be eating bodies. But anyway, they all eat raw meat, and it works fine for them because the gut is short and it can get out. When they're making compost with meat in it, they need to get it out of the gut quickly, because if they don't, it's going to make a really bad mess. And if you want to figure that out, go out to your garden compost pile where you've got vegetable scraps and soil and manure, hopefully, and throw a dead animal on there and come back in a few days and see how much you like it. I mean, before it had a slight sour smell, but not bad at all. You could be around it easily. When there's a dead animal, it's a whole different deal. And the microorganisms whose job it is to break down flesh of any kind of animal or human when it's dead, they're just doing their natural job. But some of the byproducts of the decomposition process that they facilitate are really nasty. And if you have them in your body, then it's not surprising at all that they result in things like colon cancer and other stuff like that. The raw meat people are right that it should be raw, but they're not right in the sense that you have to have a different gut and a whole different organism in order to really be suitable to use it. So my point was, and bring up the raw meat diet and the vegetarian stuff and everything, is that very often the psychological and consciousness aspect is overlooked. And I'm trying to just give you a little bit of exposure to what that part is actually like, because it's critically important. And it's important to be aware of what's going on inside yourself. If you're not, you're going to wonder why it's so hard and takes so much willpower to do something you know you should do. It's like people who are addicted to cigarettes, which are one of the nastiest drugs out there. They turn your lungs black. They definitely drag you toward lung cancer and other organ damage, and they start doing their damage on the very first time you breathe them in. I'm sorry. And you know, one of the things that happens with these drug addictions is that they start hacking into your mind immediately. And they start working on excuses of why you should protect them and keep using them forever. And I don't care what drug it is. It can be cigarettes, alcohol, cocaine, even medical painkillers and antidepressants, which are some of the worst, most damaging drugs out there. And in fact, Dr. Cousins on our show talked about how they don't have any benefits. They're a lot like vaccines. It's really easy to do a cost-benefit analysis of pros and cons, because there are no pros. It's all damage. So when I'm talking about addiction, addiction is not just physical. You know, it is physical, but, and don't think, oh God, I'm glad I'm not an addict. You know, all these stupid drug addicts, you know, why don't they just get over it? My life is fine. And if you look at it honestly, every single person is dealing with some kind of addiction. I've never met one that's not. And it just gets finer and finer levels as you get down into it further. But it's there. So instead of thinking, you know, in a condemning way of somebody else who's got a drug addiction that you don't think you have, it's much more useful to think, all right, recalibrate to zero now. No criticism of anybody. What addictions do I have? And if you don't see any negative ones, keep looking. It means you're not being quiet enough to really see inside yourself. And when you do, this is what I'm talking about, being able to get rid of these things. The only way to get rid of them is to get to levels really deeply inside yourself and change some things around. So before I get further into that, I just want to make a comment about education. Because tomorrow night we have an incredible guest on the Sunday evening show. I hope all of you will make an effort to either hear it live or as an archive. And it's a foreign correspondent for New American Magazine. His name is Alex Newman. And I first heard about him on, actually not about him, I heard him talking on Alex Jones's show. And you know, I'm always recommending that you get news from Alex Jones's show. And I know a lot of people absolutely think he's terrible, but I've never talked to any of them that had any substance to their objections at all. And I found it to be just awesomely inspiring as far as the job that Alex is doing on bringing worldwide and national news to everybody with incredible commentary and historical perspective. He's read thousands of books that I just find amazing, biographies and history, and done so much analysis. And now over 20 years, he's had quality of guests on his show that have added to the whole education. And it's, as long as it's still on the air, I mean, I just think it's amazing. And it's worth the $6 a month to pay Prison Planet TV to go there and make sure that you've got the ability to see it live on video, as long as it's still available. So the reason I mentioned Alex's show is that's where I saw Alex Newman, and Alex Newman is a teacher of economics and other things at a school called Freedom Project Academy. You're going to hear more about that tomorrow night. It should be really exciting. But the reason I wanted to get him on, and I've wanted to do a show about education for a long time, is that, you know, when you get born into this level of existence that they call three-dimensional reality, or, you know, the whole universe, or various terms, as if there's nothing else. In the beginning, you know, you're kind of figuring out how your body works and moving your hands and feet around. You know, trying to figure out what's going on. What are all these colors, shapes, and sounds, and things like that? And you basically have no idea what's going on, and you don't have any idea who you are, unless you're a really, really unusually focused being. And I've known one or more of those, a handful of those, and they're very different, not in who they really are, but in who their awareness, in their awareness of who they really are. There are some of those beings around. It's just you don't hear about them all the time. So when you're trying to figure out what's going on, what you're doing here, you know, you don't remember before you came. Some people do, but most don't. Education starts then. And education is primarily something that you give to yourself. But you can be around people that inspire and encourage you and kind of jar you to think outside the box that you were afraid to go beyond, you know, because fear keeps coming in and saying, well, you know, it's not making this conscious, but subconsciously it's saying, if you let yourself learn about things beyond what you've already gotten comfortable with memorizing, then who knows what'll happen. You know, it might threaten your entire belief system. And that would be terrible, right? You don't know what would go on, and maybe the world would fall apart or something along that line. But if you get brave and courageous and you realize that you've got this intuitive feeling that whatever's ultimately real is good. I mean, good is real understatement. It's actually beyond spectacular, but just say it's good, then why do you need to be afraid of learning things you don't know or learning things that aren't even addressed in your current belief system? The only reason you'd be afraid is if you're really not sure if the reality is really good or not. But at a certain point, you get this strong inner feeling like, you know, maybe it's called faith, but it's based on a long forgotten memory that there's some really wonderful reality behind everything that makes everything worthwhile and means that in the long run, we're all going to be okay because we're permanent beings. And this is impossible for people to understand until they get to a certain point of self-awareness. that they're not the physical body, that they're not even the mind. They're consciousness or something that consciousness tries to describe that's not going away. You can't kill it. You can't destroy it. You can't really do anything to it. The only thing that you can do, cause pain through is aspects of the existence during physical life. Now, unfortunately, there's a lot of pain that can happen during physical life. The world is just full of it. And once you start becoming aware of it, it hurts just like it's your own body because of the deep connection that we've all got to each other. And so you start thinking, you know, there are various motivations to learning and making things better. One is that you want, you know, your own limited personal life and maybe your family and people that you know to get through this, you know, smoother and achieve the things you want, stuff like that. But then gradually, very gradually, you start realizing that you want everybody to be okay. And it's good to get to that point, because before then, you might be thinking, oh, you want the good people to be okay, but you want everybody else to be destroyed. Or at least stopped. But, you know, when you're in the justice phase, you want the bad people to suffer to make up for what they've done. But the problem with that is there's a couple of problems that come up immediately. One is the bad people are only bad down to a certain level. Below that, they didn't come from any different place than you came from or that I came from. And ultimately, at that really deep level, as hard as it is to accept sometimes with the kind of horrible things that many of the, especially power people are doing and some of the regular people, they're not any different than us. So, you know, the great spiritual teachers did not condemn the bad people. They didn't say, well, you should be punished forever. They said, you know, we want to love you and help you and get you back to who you really are and away from the illusion so that you start acting completely differently, not artificially, but because it becomes natural. And this just boggles the mind of people who are still on the justice phase, who are just, you know, they just want to, they want to do the worst possible things to the bad people so then they can have world peace and all the good people can live together happily. And it doesn't work. It ends up causing more problems because if this doesn't, you know, sound mechanically sound, but it really is. And underneath at the lower levels, we have such deep connections to everybody else. And that's why whatever we do to others or for them comes back to us multiplied, and it absolutely does not depend on what you believe. It's what you call a law of nature. And it's not just big official actions, you know, like you go out and give $1,000 to charity and you get $10,000 back or something. It's every second. It's what you think about or for other people, what you wish for them. It doesn't even have to get to the level of conscious thought, an official thought. Well, I wish this person has a great day or a horrible day or whatever you're wishing for somebody. And it doesn't matter who it is you're wishing it for. And it can be just a momentary flash of a feeling. We're in a level of existence that's so meticulously engineered this way. It's way beyond what human intellect could ever grasp. It's that finely organized, basically infinitely fine. And so if you want good results, you know, in whatever you're doing, you have no option but to become self-aware, which generally we're not at all. So you have to recalibrate to zero. Forget thinking constantly how much you know, and talking to myself too. I'm not coming from above anybody on any of this. As I said, I probably made more mistakes than you have by far. But you, once you realize a little bit of what's going on, you say, wow, I actually don't know anything. So how about just observing, especially in myself, and saying, what am I feeling and thinking? And just watch what's happening around you, but mostly watch what's happening inside you. And once you're open to that, start looking for places where you're blocking, where you're holding on to some particular belief that is going to block you from seeing whatever is true, and let it relax. And as you find those points of tension inside your own awareness, and you give them conscious permission to relax, at which point they have to relax because you're in charge. It's your body. It's your consciousness, and it's your mind, and it's your emotions. Nobody else has any say over any of it. And when you do that, it changes everything. And one of the things it changes is that if you find out something about the physical laws of nature that we've mentioned before, and we'll talk about again, because that's how to understand protocol for healing procedures. When you learn those things, it's easy to change your habits. Addictions just fall off. And remember, I'm talking about your addictions. Everybody has addictions to something. When you don't, you become, and you can get to the place where you don't, you become a clear conduit for the life force and consciousness flowing through, and then some really amazing things happen. But prior to that, it's a matter of finding out what it is you're addicted to and not trying to remove it by force, because that does not work. And you get relapses and backlashes and, you know, bad feelings toward other people and frustration, and forget it. I mean, that's not a good procedure. The relaxation and letting it go can work. And watch for tension that comes up, because the mind is going to want to get back to a familiar program. And every time you see it, you just give it permission again to relax. And when you said you cannot, it's actually impossible to love other people in the sense of giving them, you know, your compassion and well wishes and really sincerely wanting good for them. You can't do that unless you wish that and give that to yourself. So forget about selfishness versus selflessness. They're all the same. Serve yourself, but it doesn't mean at the expense of other people, because that hurts you. It means be kind to yourself, you know, be compassionate, stop blaming yourself about the mistakes you've made up to now in your life. I just was into punishing myself for stupid mistakes for years and years, and thought, how could you have been this big of an idiot? You know, and once you realize some of the things that you may have done, that's an easy reaction to have. But as long as you're punishing yourself, then you're sending really negative, you know, destructive wishes into your own body, which just, even the cells give up hope, because they all are full of consciousness and they respond to the energy that you give them. And this has been documented in what's called science now, and that, you know, when you're optimistic and feeling really good and happy toward yourself, your body reacts in kind. And when you're despairing, which self-criticism produces, then all your body functions are compromised. So punishing yourself does absolutely no good. Punishing anybody else does absolutely no good. You have to stop, you know, it's necessary to stop acts against other people. But as far as causing pain to the perpetrators, that's always counterproductive. You don't need to do it. It's not, that's a very low level way to learn through pain. It creates fear, fear of further pain. And fear of anything is not a good way to operate. It's the opposite of love, and it always, always creates bad effects. So even when people say fear of good things, even fear of God or spirit, wait a minute, you know, you need to see there's something wrong with that concept, because love is the last thing in the world you have to be afraid of. If God is really nasty and he's going to send you to hell forever because he loves you so much, then you might want to be afraid of that. But even really bad things, being afraid of them is useless. They're still really bad. And so you might as well drop any fear of anything and start learning the other way through love and relaxing the blocking and the tension in yourself. And then when you make a change, you're not going to have a backlash, because you're not doing it through willpower. You're not doing it through fear, which is full of tension. You're doing it through total relaxation and letting the reality or the life force flow through you. And that creates healing. So anyway, loving yourself empties the glass. You know, they call it, if the glass is full, I know they talked about this in Avatar and a lot of other inspiring movies, and they said if the glass is full, or the lady who was the spiritual leader of the people in the forest in Avatar, she said, it's very difficult to teach somebody or pour water or something into a glass that's already full, talking to Jake in that movie. And so if you want to empty the glass, just stop punishing yourself. Start loving yourself instead. Complete compassion. You'll see that nothing terrible comes out of it. And that experience will show you that complete forgiveness and compassion toward everybody else, including the worst people in the world, the ones doing the most atrocities, all it does is make you much, much stronger. And it puts you on a level that they can't get to unless and until they're willing to give up their negative intent, and then it opens up for them as well. But my feeling is the people at the top of the negative power structure, who are the ones ultimately behind, you know, the chemtrail attacks, the nuclear power, the chemical agriculture, the poisoned water, and all the rest of it, they know that their weak spot, their Achilles heel, or the point of vulnerability on the Death Star, you know, in Star Wars, that weak spot is the fact that if a few of us get to a certain level of consciousness that I'm, you know, in a really inadequate way trying to talk about, the whole game stops, because there's so much healing power, so much light at that level that they can't reach, that we would no longer be able to be victimized by anybody or anything. We need to get there. I would suggest getting there as soon as possible, because, you know, personally, I just really don't like all of the unnecessary suffering that's going on in all over the world right now. Feels to me like, you know, me and it's you and it's all of us really in all these forms. So, I mean, it's not unnecessary in the sense that it creates learning and we get spiritual lessons from it, but I think we had enough. I mean, if I was going to vote on it, that's what I'd vote for, us just to become aware now, change our whole means of operating, and stop the game of torture and suffering right away. And when you're doing your education and your self-education all the time, it doesn't mean stopping what you have to do. You just do that at the same time. Just search for the root. This is one of the holistic principles in health. It's fine to know about the symptoms, but they don't give you the leverage to stop and reverse the disease. You got to deal with the root. And then gradually you're going to understand the symptoms and the details and how they operate to some extent. But you don't want to worry about the fact that the symptoms and the details and the physiology and all that is infinitely complex. And this is the reason that what they call science is constantly changing what they believe in. And, you know, they come up with a theory and they say, well, this absolutely is the reason for this disease or the reason for this event. And then later on they say, well, actually that was completely wrong, but now we really understand the ultimate cause. And it just keeps going forever, because there are no end to the details, and they're ultimately way beyond the capacity of the human intellect to fully understand. So if we want to get the answer to even just solving physical illness that way, it's going to be a very, very long wait. But if you switch your focus from the symptoms to the root cause of whatever it is you're looking at, now you've got leverage to actually understand something and to change what you're doing and to change the result. So you may not be able to fully describe the root cause, and you know, it may be something so deep that it's beyond words, but you can bring yourself into harmony with it, and then all the results change. So prerequisite to being able to take advantage of the laws of nature, once you learn about those, there's just no way around having to love yourself. So if you're punishing yourself internally for something you did or didn't do, forget it. The punishment is never going to make you into a better person. It might make you afraid, but it's never going to fix anything. It doesn't mean let murderers run around in society and shoot everybody and not stop them. They have to be stopped, even if some of them have to be, you know, end up being killed by their so-called victims or intended victims. But what I'm saying is causing evildoers pain for the sake of that, thinking that's going to fix things, is not just a waste of time. It's absolutely suicidal for us. So you have to stop things that are bad. And when you're called on to do it, you have to defend people or yourself or put a stop to some bad thing that's going on. Yeah, that's those are the activities that we're all working on. But forget your desire to have anyone suffer, including bad guys. Because if you wish that for anybody whatsoever, it comes to you. So what does that mean? Well, what happens if you wish the opposite? What happens if you, not in your head, not just say the words, because that does absolutely nothing. That's called affirmations, and you can be affirming the most wonderful things with your intellectual mind while you're harboring all kinds of hideous emotional junk underneath, and it doesn't help you at all. But if you can get quiet enough, you have to first do what we said of becoming aware of what you're feeling and thinking, because that's the level that you have to change. And if you turn that around and silently wish on a feeling level and mean it, good things for everybody, even the really so-called bad people, now you're going to start seeing change inside yourself and in people on the outside. And once you realize how much power there is in that, you're going to want to just use it all the time, and you're going to play with it and have fun with it, and no one has to know what you're doing. They're going to wonder why they feel really good around you, but they're not going to know what you're doing unless they're doing it too. And then if they're doing it too, they're going to recognize you right away. So once you do that, whatever your negative addictions might be, whether they're, you know, saying kind of cruel jokes to other people or trying to put other people down or have power over them, or maybe you're addicted toward, you know, just eating constantly things that taste good but you know aren't very good for you, or taking some kind of drug, or maybe you're drinking or smoking, or depending on marijuana, something, which marijuana is not all bad. It's got some good qualities as a plant, but if you want them, lighting it on fire and inhaling the burning particles into your lungs is not brilliant. You know, the lungs are not designed to breathe in solid particles. They can fight back against some of it, like, you know, on a smoky day if there's a forest fire or something near you. But that's not good for them. They need fresh air. So my advice is don't smoke anything at all. And if you... You know, the thing about marijuana, the THC in it, the psychoactive component, which we've talked a little bit about with Dr. Cousins, who's on our show pretty frequently, is that if you're in such a weakened, unstable position that you're prone to violence and you can't control your emotional balance and you're just really, you know, not centered, and you tend to do damage to other people verbally, physically, or any other way, marijuana tends to make you feel like zoned out. I don't know how better to say it. Not care about what's going on. And I think that's the main way that it eases pain, is it brings in this uncaring, relaxed feeling, which is not at all helpful for you if you want to become conscious. But if it's a question between, you know, beating up the people around you and then just, or zoning out into a chair watching cartoons or watching nothing or whatever you're going to do, then probably being zoned out is a lot better for you than inflicting violence on other people. I've actually seen smokers of marijuana save other people from trauma by doing that to themselves. But ultimately, when you get brave enough to grow, I've been watching people using marijuana since the 60s when I was in the university, and it's always been destructive. Relaxing, but destructive in the sense that it makes you not care, and it makes your mind fuzzy, and probably doesn't hurt you nearly as much as alcohol or even conventional cigarettes, but it's not a good thing. I've never seen any evidence of it really being healing, but people do feel that way about it. And if you want it for that, there's a couple of ways to get it. One is if you have it fresh and you can legally get it fresh and you can juice it. There's a guy in Scandinavia, I forget his name, but he said it's one of the strongest healing fresh juices, fresh green juices that you can get. It probably tastes really bad, but he says it's very healing. The other thing is there's a component called CBD that Dr. Cousins agrees I think is really good. Has no THC. It's not psychoactive. It doesn't get you high, in quotes. I put that in quotes because there are real highs that are way better than that, which you can get without any external drugs at all. And you can just live in the real high, whereas the marijuana high is fake, and it ultimately doesn't take you to a good place. But the CBD doesn't have that high aspect, and it's been attributed with a lot of healing properties. It's sold as a supplement, and Dr. Rima Lebo, a frequent guest and friend on this show, her organization, Natural Solutions Foundation, sells it. And you can go to her site, drrimatruthreports.com, and see if you want to get some. But, you know, I'm advocating getting high, but not with drugs. With things that are inherent to you and that come out automatically when you stop blocking them. And there are ways that we are blocking things. You know, one of the main ways to accomplish things, and I know this will sound strange, is to stop blocking them. Not so much create an achievement, but just stop blocking it in yourself. And there are subtle ways that we're blocking anything that we wanted to achieve and we're not getting yet. The cause of not getting it is almost always inside yourself. In fact, in some way, it is always inside yourself. So that's really the key to everything, is become internally conscious and see what happens. It's going to revolutionize absolutely everything for you. And then as you do that, you become more capable of actually putting into practice changes in your daily routine without slipping back. And of course, if you do slip back, that's an opportunity for you not to punish yourself, not to think critically of yourself, just to go back and redirect yourself and start again. So remember, we've got the talked a lot about the Essene Gospel of Peace, the first volume, which is the one that I really relate to for healing. And the in the Essene Gospel of Peace, it's all about the laws of nature. And it's an incredible book. And it's talking about how if you get yourself back in harmony with those laws, then your diseases are going to go away. Basically, what we call old age is going to gradually start going away. In our society, most of us have done so much damage to our bodies, and I'm including myself. I've really, you know, took me forever to learn the basics of this stuff, during which time I lost some teeth and, you know, got damage to other parts of my body, and I didn't even know what I was doing. But eventually, I did figure out how the system works. To a great degree, and there's much, much more to do. Of course, I'm just a beginner on this stuff, but I've got enough of it going on that I need to share it with any of you that have an interest. So anyway, what I was going to say is the laws of nature as described in that book, the first thing that is attempted to explain is that all of so-called nature is conscious, all of it. So we are not learning about, this is one thing that what passes for science now doesn't even have any clue to, except in certain really advanced circles, that all of us came from a conscious source. This is not just that a bunch of atoms just happened to line up a certain way and suddenly everything was just evolved on its own into what it is now. This all came out of a consciousness beyond description. And it's still in all of us, but it's also all in nature. So when you're learning about the laws of nature, it's not a matter of intellectually memorizing a long list of different things. It's a matter of harmonizing with an energy or with a consciousness that's in everything. And then from there, you start automatically wanting to change what you're doing. And whatever you're working on in the outside world will start having different results, which right now are limited by whatever it is that we're doing internally. So the basic laws of nature that are talked about in that book, which you can get, you don't even have to buy it. If you're interested in it, you can see it as a PDF online. Someone typed the whole thing. It's just a short book based on an old document. And it's called, you just get a search engine. And I like to use, it's one with a funny name, DuckDuckGo. Or StartPage is okay, but StartPage is still apparently a Google clone. DuckDuckGo is not. And we're trying to minimize surveillance and intrusions on privacy. So that's a good search engine. And if you put the Essene Gospel of Peace, Volume 1, into that, and put the letters PDF also, then it just comes up and you can read it for free. You don't even have to buy it. It's getting harder to buy anyway. It's almost out of print. Hopefully it'll be reprinted soon. And it's just so beautifully written that it's hard to make any commentary that doesn't fall way short of the original writing. But the basic idea is that it's talking about in terms of Mother Earth and her angels, like water, air, sunlight. There's some archaic language in there, but it's definitely completely relevant for now and still actually operative and true. And you know, another thing about using language to talk about these esoteric and subtle things is that one of the things that our rulers are doing right now is trying to control society through language, not just in the censorship that's happening now. And they are starting to want people not to say mother and father anymore, or boy and girl. I mean, it's getting really insane and extreme. Some of the schools are saying they want to call the boys and girls all purple penguins so they don't have to hurt anybody's feelings by saying boy or girl. It's trying to get you totally out of touch with, you know, just common sense, simplicity. But another, on another level, if you look at a high up organization like the United Nations, they're taking phrases like Mother Earth or Gaia, which is a really deep concept and has a lot of meaning to it, and they're turning it around into a justification for Agenda 21 and giving up all your rights and not using energy anymore and turning off your heater to save the earth, all this total nonsense. And the reason that that last thing is total nonsense is because clean and free energy sources have been available in the current time, at least since 1920. We haven't needed petroleum energy since then. And the reason people are using oil and coal and everything is not because they're evil. It's because it's all we're allowed to use. Nuclear power is at least as bad. And so they're the United Nations, under the direction of the higher leadership, is using the concept of Mother Earth and Gaia, saying Gaia is alive. And I really apologize to everybody who's going to, you know, hate me for saying this, but they're right. It's absolutely true. Gaia is alive. Mother Earth is alive. She's a very deep, very conscious being. She's not a pile of rock like the Earth physically, any more than we're a pile of meat in our body. She's the consciousness in that body, and very powerful, very love-oriented being, completely benevolent. But the rulers decided they'd take that idea, what they say, co-opt it for their own purposes, and say Gaia wants everybody to stop using energy. Ultimately, that means stop breathing, of course, because you're giving off carbon dioxide, ruining the world, right? And live in poverty and hopefully, you know, use nothing in order to save the world and save Gaia. Completely ridiculous. And, you know, obviously ridiculous, except for the fact that people have gotten hypnotized to believe some of this brainwashing. And, you know, I think I saw a bumper sticker even years before this officially became UN policy that we should all stop using all the energy in our life. And it said, what did it say? Save the earth, kill yourself, or save the planet, kill yourself. Ultimately, that is the plan. And they want to convince us that that's the most benevolent thing you can do, is first stop living and then kill yourself if possible. And, you know, just basically the top leadership is worshiping pain and destruction and death. And they're using otherwise meaningful language turned to negative intent. The same has happened with organic, because organic is really a valid term. When I was in the university in the mid-60s, we were growing organic food at this incredible garden, because I happened to run into this genius, Alan Chadwick. Not genius in that he memorized 10,000 books. He was a genius because he was in touch directly with the person we just talked about, which is Mother Earth, Gaia. He would stand in the middle of that garden, which started out as a barren hillside full of poison oak and rock, and just not move with his eyes closed for 5 minutes. He wasn't putting on a show. He was directly in touch with another level of intelligence. And when he opened his eyes, he told us everything that had to be done for the whole day in great detail, not memorized out of a book. And when we did it, the result was transformational. And we made this incredibly beautiful organic in the real sense of the word, organic garden. And we would put the flowers and the vegetables and everything that we grew out on this little stand. It looked like kind of a school bus stop, you know, at the side of the small street that went through it on the university. And people would stop by there and just take the vegetables and flowers for free. No one ever took more than they needed. And it just spread this incredible atmosphere of beauty through the whole place. And eventually people would stop and visit the garden and visit Alan Chadwick, the the person who, you know, was the source of it. Well, not the source, the conduit of the source of it. And by the way, stopped by for a few minutes to see the university, but what they really wanted to see was him and the garden. So that was an example of harmonizing with the laws of nature. And what happened later, since there are hundreds of thousands of people being used by the power structure to figure out strategy and how to corrupt absolutely everything in our lives, they took the word organic, which was beautiful in its original meaning, and they turned it into an official U.S. Department of Agriculture phrase or word. And they made the USDA organic program, even though you know that they're not benevolent and they don't have good intent, because the same USDA, Department of Agriculture, is one of the biggest promoters of GMOs on the planet. You know, the plants that have been genetically changed so that they can do advanced functions like cause cancer, organ damage, total sterility in three generations in test animals. That's USDA. And until they stop being corrupted, they're totally not to be trusted at all. But the word organic was good, just like Gaia and Mother Earth had positive meaning. When the UN uses them, it's ultimately to destroy you. And it's tricking you, but in a subtle way, because some of what they say about Gaia, about Mother Earth, and about organic is actually true, but they're twisting it around and using it against us. So in the current situation with language, you just have to be really aware of how you're using words and how they're being used by the power structure that we're living under in some ways. And a lot of things you have to reverse the meaning that you're told in order to understand what they really mean. So the current educational system is primarily, all the way from daycare through PhD and beyond, is there so that you'll lose touch with your ability to think and your ability to have common sense and your ability to understand what's in you and around you. And the medical system, other than repairing injuries and congenital birth defects and things, is there to get everybody addicted for life to medical drugs, vaccines, and to lose the ability to be healthy and to think clearly. The CDC is there to make sure that disease never goes away. And FDA is there to make sure that food never becomes healthy. So once you start understanding how to decode those things, then your education takes a big step. And when you're wanting to reset your body and get closer to a way of everyday, you know, lifestyle habits that is going to save you from having to go through all these diseases that are supposedly unavoidable, incurable, and old age where it's like, you know, it's really hellish and you're degenerating into not being able to do anything in your body. You're in constant pain and you eventually don't know who anybody is. That's not normal. It's very predictable that we're going to get into that because of what we're doing every day. And one of the reasons people don't recognize it and don't catch it is because they're on this very slow level of frequency, which is called the physical world. There's a time gap between cause and noticeable effect. Now, in reality, there is an immediate effect to absolutely everything that you do. Every thought, every emotion that you harbor, which is your decision, it's not involuntary. Everything that you physically do, there is an immediate effect, but it's so subtle usually that people don't notice it. Like, you go out and eat an ear of GMO corn. Well, that's deadly, but usually not right away. And I just finished objecting to Whole Foods corporate office that they're saying that they're really wanting to take care of us, but they sell fresh GMO corn and they don't even let the customers know. So it's obvious that at the corporate level, they don't care anything about their customers except how much money they get from them. This is what's called modern business. We learned it in business school, which I went through. And it says, whatever you can legally get away with, or even if it's illegal, if you don't get caught, that's just really great business. And a lot of these problems are society or because people are getting out of touch with any sense of ethics. It's not something you have to memorize out of a book. I mean, I'm certainly not against things like the Ten Commandments, but you shouldn't need them because where did you come from? What's your source? You know, who made you and what are you made out of? Well, where these codes of conduct, the good ones, came from is where you came from. So you don't need to have ever seen a book to know these things if you tune into yourself. And that's what I'm suggesting that, you know, we need to do. So when the laws of nature were being taught in the Essene Gospel, Volume 1, they talked about what should be obvious, and they will be obvious again when we're conscious again of in our normal state. But when people get diverted and, you know, the body gets dirty and malnourished and things like that, you lose touch. You forget the obvious simplicity, like you need clean water. Okay, so you never want to drink water out of plastic, even the best water in the world, because plastic is petroleum. And it leaches hormone-disrupting chemicals and other things into the water, even if it's fantastic water. And we got millions and millions of people drinking water out of very thin, leachable plastic and thinking that they're, you know, that's a health practice. No, it's a health-destroying practice. And if you, you know, we talked about it not being immediately available. If you're really tuned in, the first sip of water that you take out of a plastic bottle, you're going to throw it away because you're going to taste it and you're going to feel intuitively what it's doing to your body and your brain. But most of us are not tuned into that. So, you know, 10 years later when we get diagnosed with all kinds of diseases and the doctor says, well, it must be genetic or just bad luck, or an even better one is, well, you're a certain age now, so you're supposed to fall apart. You know, that's complete nonsense. So the as you get wiser, you don't want to wait till the final obvious inescapable result comes up. You want to start tuning in so that you feel immediate results. It's called getting really sensitive to what's going on, which you can do. But again, the power structure says, you know, they have things called sensitivity training. Not the kind that used to be done at Esalen Institute in Big Sur, but sensitivity training, like knowing what politically correct thing you have to say all the time and getting rid of your own honest, normal language. I don't mean that. I mean real sensitivity to what's actually going on so that you can be aware of it. Sensitivity comes from the same word root as sensor, like the sensor in a car. There's a sensor in your car that senses if the oil pressure is okay. And if you didn't have it, and there's a hole in the oil pan and you lose all the oil, you're just going to blow up your engine. And you wouldn't even know it until it blows up or freezes up or stops working. And then it's really expensive and it's no good anymore. And we have those sensors built in to our own consciousness that are wired into our body. So those sensors don't do any good unless they're operating. It's just like in the car. And getting them operational again is the positive meaning of sensitivity. So that kind of sensitivity training is really good. Everybody needs to give it to themselves. And what that, it takes you right back to making the subconscious conscious. What, stop whatever you're thinking and feeling now, or be aware of it, and then look on a quieter level. What am I thinking under that? that reactivates your sensors. And it's actually positive sensitivity training. So it has practical uses. You're not going to be able to drink water out of plastic because you're going to instantly feel it tastes terrible. It tastes destructive. It tastes like poison. You can taste the plastic. You'd never drink it. And it's not because you can recite all the reasons in the books why it's bad for you. It has nothing to do with that. You know, the animals who reject GMO corn right away, the rats will go from GMO corn over to non-GMO organic corn. And they don't even have PhDs as far as we know. And they haven't probably even read any books. They don't speak English or any other human language. And they know faster than a human with 10 PhDs. The rats are not the only ones with that ability. You have that and 1,000 times more. So the real sensitivity, getting it back, is to tune back into that. Don't be afraid of it. Be curious. Let it start operating again. See where it leads you. Because the sensors that you were given are not to hurt you. They're to help you. And operating without them gets you into all kinds of trouble. So the Essene Gospel said, you know, you need clean water. You need to bathe in it, not chlorine and fluoride. You know, if you're stuck in a city and they're dumping poison in the water, at least put a filter on your shower that is capable of removing fluoride, which is one of the finest sized particles to get out because it's a liquid acid in its current form, a couple of different acids. And you need a shower filter or a bath filter or something that will take it out, because drinking is not the only way that you get that. You absorb just as much when you bathe in it. So again, if your sensors were working, you'd jump out of that bathtub or that shower and you'd never get in it again until it's filtered. And if it's old metal pipes in the city, they're full of lead and arsenic and all kinds of other stuff that you don't want to be taking immediately into your bloodstream. And if you question whether they go into your bloodstream in a shower, no, the water doesn't just fall off your skin. Your skin is porous. And that's why birth control patches work. They put the birth control chemical into your blood. The stopping smoking patches work for the same reason, because they put the nicotine dose into your blood through your skin. Fluoride goes into your skin the same way. So you have to start tuning into this stuff. Clean up your water. There's a brand of spring water that's sold all over the country that's, I think, is really good, called Mountain Valley Spring Water. It's in green glass, not plastic. It's got a red label on it. Not the carbonated one, but just the regular one, Mountain Valley Spring Water. And it's very good to drink, as far as I can tell. I've been using it for about 10 years or so. I used distilled water for about 20 years before that, but it's not as good. And there's real question about distilled water, because it wants a certain mineral balance in it. And if it doesn't have it, it may take it out of your body, which is not something beneficial. So if you're going to use highly filtered water or distilled water, which is way better than contaminated water, then my idea is just get a little bit of Himalayan salt from the natural food store and put just a tiny bit of that in, and that balances it osmotically, and so it won't be dragging minerals that you want out of your body. That seems to work fine. And if you don't do that with distilled water and your sensors are working, it tastes kind of acid and it doesn't taste good. This kills that and balances it. And then in your food, We've gotten way, way out of touch with nature on food. Like we talked about before, humans are not designed to be carnivores at all. Even in the best state, which is eating it raw as the animal's dying, that's not what humans are designed for. And if you missed it, listen to the archive. We talked about the reasons that's obvious. In fact, any bad smells that are coming out of your body that make you need deodorants or anything like that, those are huge glaring warning signs. When your body gets clean and well-nourished, it smells fresh even if it's not washed for months. I know it's hard to grasp, but it's absolutely true. Unless you fall in a pile of something that smells bad, and then you're going to have to wash it off, but hopefully with filtered clean water. But in the food thing, we are so far off normal that you have two choices. If your health is acceptable right now or not too bad, you're not immediately going to die as far as you know, you can start gradually changing what you eat back to normal, away from the insanity that we've gotten hypnotized into. But if you have a really serious, like, you know, potentially fatal disease that you know of, and this is just my opinion for myself, but you can't fool around at that point. You have to go all the way to the other end of the spectrum. You know, completely change what you're eating and drinking in the right way, hopefully with the help of somebody who knows exactly how to do it, because you don't want to fool around at that point. And you can't just do gradual changes. But you have to do them right. So it has to be somebody familiar with how to do that, which unleashes the healing power of the body. That if you're alive, you have it. You just need to activate it. But if you're going to do it gradually, which most people will, I know when Matt Mark was on our show, he said the first thing is stop eating processed foods. And I think he's completely right. He's got a great video on that. A lot of great videos. Rawfoodworld.com is his website. He's great, great guy. And, you know, he's a vegan. He's been a raw vegan for like 22 years. But he actually, you know, most of the raw vegans think I'm kind of really off track because I use raw milk. But he doesn't think so. He thinks it's actually something good, is what he told me. He just doesn't talk about it too much on his videos, but he knows about it. And he said the first thing is getting off processed foods. Processed food is like a food in a box or a can or a jar or something that is not the original food, you know, like a head of cabbage or something. It's processed and it ends up as a paragraph of ingredients on the container, some of which you probably can hardly pronounce. That's processed food. And in the real sense, though, I mean, even something like flour, which is in so many things, is a processed food. Because when you take a seed like a wheat seed or rice seed or anything like that, which has life force in it and it's ready to sprout when it gets wet, and you grind it up, as soon as you grind it, it starts to oxidize. And if it sits in a bag as flour for any length of time at all, it's completely dead. The life force is gone, even if it's raw. And the other thing is people, you know, are not, human beings are not set up to digest raw flour or raw grain, except for fresh corn. And interesting that that's one that they've chosen to destroy in the U.S. by making it all GMO. But that one we're set up to digest, but not the other ones like wheat and the other dry grains. But you can still eat it if you sprout it and then eat the grass from it. But eating it as a flour product is pretty much always destructive. And that's a huge staple, not only in the U.S., but all over the world. So I would treat flour as a processed food. It's not as bad as the ones that are full of fake ingredients and chemicals, but it's destructive in the sense that there's no life force remaining in it. And what I found is that the primary nutrient, even preceding vitamins and minerals and everything else, is life force. And then if that's in the food, that's going to do you a lot of good. And if it's not, the body has to treat it as a waste product and get rid of it with very little usable material. So I would say that's true. And then if you can go beyond that, it takes a while just to get to that point. And, you know, even if you're still eating meat, at least you don't eat processed meat with nitrates in it and stuff like that. But ultimately, if you want to be healthy, in my opinion, you have to get away from meat. And everybody's got that choice, unless you happen to live, you know, in the Arctic zones of the northern or south hemisphere. And then it's not very good gardening weather up there. And pretty much the only animals that make it are carnivores. So you have to make believe that you are one. If you're living in the Eskimo areas or places like that, it's not their fault. That's where their long, you know, ancient ancestors migrated to. And that's actually what seemed to cause this division of people into so-called races, is that most likely, you know, a couple hundred thousand years ago or so, all of us originated in southern Africa in our current form. And then some groups migrated to cold areas, and some groups stayed there, and some groups migrated to temperate or tropical areas. And generation after generation, the body has intelligence and consciousness, and it knows how to, you know, help protect itself. So since sunlight is a real major nutrient, but there's only so much of it that your body can process, the people whose ancestors stayed in the tropical areas, they had to increase the melanin, the color pigment in their skin, to moderate the amount of sun that they would get. And so they looked darker color, not black. I mean, I don't think I've ever met a black person, actually. I know what the color black is. It's seen in things like charcoal. And I've never met a human being that was black. But there are people with really a lot of melanin whose skin is pretty dark. And their ancestors generally stayed in places where there was a lot of sun most of the year. And the skin had to get to where it could filter out the right amount so that what was left was what they needed for nutrition. It's what science crudely calls vitamin D now, but there is way more to sunlight than vitamin D. Vitamin D apparently has really good effects if you're not getting enough sun. Vitamin D3, I used to take 10,000 units of it a day, which seemed about right. But I found after that it's far superior to get your exposure from the sun itself, gradually getting used to it. And the key to that is that, and this is also talked about in the Essene Gospel, that as your body gets cleaner, you have a completely different reaction to sunlight. It's almost impossible to burn your skin staying out in the sun when your body's clean. And it's comfortable. Bright light is comfortable. Don't try this at home right away. But just for information, when your body's very clean and nourished, looking right at the sun at noon is no problem at all. It's very comfortable and easy. And the more sensitive to bright light your eyes are, it's giving you clues to things that we need to pay attention to. So anyway, that's where the races came from what I can tell. And over time, people like in Scandinavia, whose ancestors lived there for a long time, their skin became very light color because they weren't getting enough sun. It's as simple as that. And over a long period of time, even the melanin in their hair started to go away, because our hair and our eyes and everything need sun. It's absolute essential nutrient, carrier of life force. So they got real pale. And so the people are all the same. Their ancestors just lived in different parts of the globe with different sun exposure. And they turned into what looks like different races. But to fight over that or to hate each other over that is really below infantile. It's really dumb. And it's completely suicidal. Because one of the deeper laws in nature, again, is whatever we wish for or feel towards other people or other beings of any kind comes back to us multiplied, and it always works. So just a brief diversion about race there. And ultimately, the people wanting to make race a big issue are the rulers of society, who want total chaos so that they have an excuse to come in and shut down last traces of freedom. So we should be smart enough to realize that we're all the same race. And the minor differences between people who look different are nothing compared to the complete individuality of every single person. And we all come from the same thing and need to support and love each other, you know, and that ends the whole race question. So the other things briefly about natural laws are, in the, to finish off the food area, first of all, humans are designed to eat uncooked food, and so are all the other creatures, animals, and everybody running around the world. None of them are designed for cooked food. So it's not something to worry about or to get stressed about or to try to force yourself to not eat cooked food when you really want to. That does not work. It creates a backlash. It ends you up, you know, gorging on the most cooked food you can possibly get. So that's why we talked about the psychological and consciousness issues, because the more you work those out, the easier it is to change anything you want with no willpower. And your addictions just fall away if you get in touch internally. So, but just to be aware of it, the more of your food you can eat uncooked, the better. And I found one of the greatest aids to being able to go completely on raw food with no craving for it at all was actually raw milk. And it there's a strong clue about that, because that's one of the foods that the power structure and the FDA and everybody has conspired to eradicate from availability as fast as they can. And even within the raw milk that is sold, they want it where they pretend to support it. They say, well, just make it grade A, so everyone's safe, right? And we're all happy, because we know germs are what is killing everybody, because they're a mistake of nature and they just, you know, make all these problems for people. Complete misunderstanding, intentional misunderstanding. Of course, the people in the power structure and FDA and everything are not saying that to be evil. They have good intent mostly. And they're saying it because that's what they were trained for. That's what they were trained as true, that germs are killing everybody and have to be eradicated, and sterilizing everything is the way to health. It's not their fault. They don't understand. Pasteur apologized for the misunderstanding of the germ theory before he died, as did Bichamp, the guy that he apparently plagiarized it from. But it was too late. You know, it was already an entrenched foundation for industries like the drug industry that justifies itself largely by killing all the evil microorganisms. It's a massive misunderstanding. So in the raw milk area, they make it, they say, well, let just make it grade A, right? And all the well-meaning enforcers who think they're saving humanity say, yeah, it has to be grade A. Otherwise, you have to warn people it's going to hurt them and going to cause all these terrible diseases, which, of course, it doesn't, as long as it's clean. But grade A, the way that they define that, is it has to have microorganism counts below a certain level. And that is the way that they make it supposedly healthy. But that gets rid of the life force, which was the main reason that the raw milk was useful. And the fact that raw milk with life force in it that's organic in the real sense of the word and still has its full count of microorganisms, which are beneficial, also has saturated fat and cholesterol, which are essential health elements and super supplements in our current condition. The saturated fat forms the foundation for most of the important hormones, and it's really hard to get from vegan sources in a raw form. And cholesterol, I mean, it's a building block in the brain, in the cell walls, in the nerve sheaths, and all over the body. Absolutely essential. So that's the thing about raw milk. It's very helpful. It helps you get more towards a raw diet. But I also found you can't mix it with anything. And this illustrates the need for you to be a scientific observer all the time, not just with food, but with everything. And in a, you know, relaxed, wide awake, focused manner, not tense, not stressed, but just watching, you know, willing to find out whatever's true, not to try to defend one point of view or another. And it turned out that raw milk really, I mean, it's very valuable, but if you mix it with other food, at least what my experience was anyway, that it made other things undigestible because the raw milk, it's a buffer of stomach acid. And so if you drink raw milk first, and it neutralizes the weak hydrochloric acid that you need in your stomach to digest your food, and then you eat food, like even fruit or something like that, it's going to go into your intestinal tract undigested, which is not a good thing. So I ended up having to use raw milk alone on an empty stomach, not eat anything right after it for a couple of hours or so, and then eat food. And then all of the positive qualities, the incredible healing qualities in the raw milk, can be acquired. I mean, it's really fantastic. And for a while, for the first, in my case, many weeks after I started using it, it caused, you know, throat problems, congestion, tiredness. I really felt like I couldn't digest it. And then I finally found out, with the help of input from some other people that knew, that the enzymes and other things that you need in your gut to digest it, you know, for example, what they call lactose intolerance, which is the lack of lactase, the enzyme that breaks down the milk sugar, that's not something about a genetic problem that you cannot get over. That's completely untrue as far as I can tell. The enzyme comes from the milk itself. That's why babies that have never eaten anything in their stomach anyway, they get the enzymes to digest the milk. And where do they get them? They get them from the milk. That's the hidden secret. So when we've really messed up the microorganisms in our gut, we're not like a new baby that's supposedly clean and can get those enzymes growing right away and the bacteria growing right away. It can take time. And it takes time, especially if you don't really clean out your system. In my case, it took many weeks. This is a long time ago. And eventually, the new colonization of bacteria from the raw milk took over, and now it works fine. So I don't get any bad symptoms from drinking the milk at all. I get lots of energy, and it feels good. And I never get sick. I never get colds or, you know, flu or whatever it is you're supposed to get when you get sick. It normally doesn't happen. And sickness, you know, what they call acute sickness with fever and stuff that the body gets is usually a positive thing, that the body's trying to throw out something that shouldn't be in it. So and fever really activates your immune system. Dr. McCullough and others have given some great talks about that. And so killing fever, unless it's at a point where it's really endangering your life, is not brilliant. And and the reason I got into that whole sidetrack is because everybody's designed biologically to run on 100% raw live food. And why I say raw live and not just raw is because, you know, there are some things that are raw but are not good for you, and you have to develop the judgment to know the difference. So if you have, you know, raw flour, I once actually did an experiment with this stuff, that you eat some raw flour, it's raw food, right? There's no life force in it at all if it's sat for any length of time. And it's raw starch, and you can't digest it. So it can make you quite sick, actually. So the fact that something is raw food doesn't mean it's good to eat. But the raw live food, you know, and even then, there are some toxic raw live foods. Like if you try to chew up a bunch of oleander leaves, they may kill you because they're an intense toxin, and they're raw live food. So don't eat them. You have to develop, and there's certain kinds of mushrooms that can kill you, and they're raw live food too. So it's not just whatever is raw and alive is great, but you have to develop the ability to learn from others, so that you don't need to make all the mistakes yourself. That's part of the reason I'm talking on the air. And also to be very sensitive, reactivate the sensors, you know, real sensitivity training, reactivate it in your body, not the politically correct nonsense, but the real one. And develop the ability to know yes or no about different things that you're going to do or different food that you're going to eat. just like the rat in the experiment with the GMO corn and the organic corn that ate the organic corn every time, all it has to know is eat this, don't eat that. And if you develop your sensing ability, bring it back to life up to the level of the rat, that's a huge advance from where humans have gotten themselves into. And then you can just go further because we actually have other abilities besides even what the rat has. So I would recommend that. And you don't have to get to raw food immediately, you know, unless you're in some really dire situation. And even then you have to work with somebody who knows how to do it. And if you're not, you can work toward it gradually. And some people find that they're quite comfortable eating mostly cooked food. If it's whole, organic, no more processed food. Matt Monarch has the opinion in his videos that if you just get to the point of dumping the processed food and the toxic stuff, the poisoned water, and things like that, that's going to be really good enough to keep you in good shape for your whole life. And that was demonstrated in the Hunza culture before it was destroyed by access to fast foods and drugs and doctors and things like that later. But originally, earlier, people went to visit the Hunzas in northern Pakistan. It was very remote. You had to be brave to even go across the paths to get there. And they weren't on all raw food. They were eating a lot of cooked food, but it was all organic out of their own gardens. It was all whole. And, you know, they would just pick it, prepare it, and eat it. A lot of it was raw, but a lot of it was cooked. And they typically lived to 140 years old and were, you know, out playing sports and stuff way past 100. They were working in the fields all day when they were that age. This was not raw food. This was just whole organic food, super good water from natural sources, clean air, which unfortunately we don't have now. And we're besieged with, you know, plastics all around us leaching into the food and water, hormone disrupting chemicals on our hands from handling receipts and all kinds of other things which, you know, come through the skin. We've got a much tougher environment than the Hunzas had. So if we want to go further than they did, they went to organic, you know, fresh, raw and cooked food. If we want to go more in the raw direction and maybe use juices that they didn't have access to and other things like that, it's probably a good idea. In fact, I'm about to start a series of experiments with a liquid mineral source that might be a really great supplement to make up for the fact that the soil is wiped out and even the so-called organic food is not as high in minerals as it should be. And this liquid is from a mineral deposit that was found in Utah, and they leach it in water, just good water, and the water absorbs a lot of the minerals from it, which come from an old plant deposit that was buried in the ground from a time when things were a lot cleaner. And I'm probably going to get a sample of it arriving here in the next week, and I'll let you know what happens to that. Certain food-based supplements can be super helpful. I know Alex Jones's InfoWarsStore.com sells a lot of great ones. They're mostly formulated by Dr. Group, who's a friend of ours and is really brilliant formulator, especially his liquid-based ones that you can take in an eyedropper and put in some water. Some of those are extremely valuable. So anyway, in the Essene Gospel, it talks about these as elements of getting back to harmony with nature. And it talks about on the way to getting to those changed habits to start with fasting. And the reason for that was that fasting is a built-in detoxification system for the body. And it's the most powerful one that I know of that ever existed. And it's also incredibly delicate, very gentle on your system. It goes, you see, because over decades of eating toxic garbage that we didn't know any better than to eat or to be exposed to in water or whatever, some of the stuff that we're breathing from the chemtrail dumping, you know, toxic metals and other stuff on us. The body is very intelligent. It's totally self-conscious, not in the bad. I mean, it's self-aware. It's not, it doesn't just have some generic intelligence in it. It's alive, aside from us, and it tries to help us. It's got a current in it that pulls it toward harmony and balance all the time. And the only reason it doesn't get there is either environmental assaults or mistakes that we make. And the part that we're doing, we can change. So when the body stops having to deal with food, it knows instantly what the next most important job is, and it's to get rid of these old stored deposits that it put away in safekeeping for some future day when it had time to deal with them, to get them out of the body so they didn't cause this fake aging and disease. And when a fast happens, it's the first time the body has free energy to take care of those things. So it starts doing surgery on every single cell at the same time. It knows where every single deposit is, even from 40 years ago or more. And it starts bringing them out into the bloodstream. And this is what happens during a fast when you're drinking only water. And the problem that makes it dangerous in current times is that we're so toxic, you know, concentrated drug residues from medical drugs or street drugs or, you know, lead and paint that we were breathing or who knows what chemical, and now GMO stuff, which is almost unthinkable poison. When that starts coming out into the blood, you don't feel very good because it's circulating in the blood and it's getting reabsorbed. So most of the great healers who have talked about using fasting, from, you know, Dr. Gerson and Arnold Arendt and all these people have talked about the absolute necessity of using body temperature water enemas when you're fasting as much as necessary so that you do not reabsorb these poisons when they come out in your blood on the way to getting out of the body. Again, work with somebody, you know, who's a real experienced expert on this kind of stuff so that you keep yourself safe and learn about it yourself. Become the expert yourself because you're really the most trustable expert in your own life. And you need to start immediately doing anything you can to reawaken that in yourself, learn from the mistakes of others, and develop your own automatic built-in insight into these things, because it's not going to come out of the intellect. That's a supporting secondary faculty that you have, but it is not nearly as intelligent as the built-in sense of what's what. So now, you know, we can moderate the fasting to make it easier to take in a hostile environment by using juices. You can learn a lot about that by just going online and putting in juice fasting or juice feasting or sometimes juice fasting and a certain disease. And people will have put their experience in there. That's super valuable. And you can learn a lot from those people's experiences. YouTube is this vast resource and library. It's just totally incredible. So find the ones that are good and where the people just gave their honest experiences and start learning about it. also from people like Matt Monarch and one of the really experienced fasting people is Lauren Lockman, L-O-R-E-N. I think it's L-O-C-K-M-A-N in Costa Rica. He's actually got a center where people are put on water fasts, not juice fasts. It's very, you know, intense. And I have to say, you know, don't do any of this stuff without checking with your doctor. We don't give medical advice. I'm just sharing observations with you. Lauren Lockman's got a ton of really interesting videos on YouTube. I think his place is called Tanglewood. Very fascinating to learn from what he's done. And there's a juice fasting place in Portugal that's also done a lot of fantastic work called Juicy Oasis. And it might be just .com for their website, but you can find it out by putting it into a search engine. And last time I checked, which was a few months ago, they were just putting people on long juice fasts. And with juice, you're getting nutrients. So you can often go months on juice with no food. No other food. And they were curing all kinds of diseases. I mean, this is not going to be researched by the medical industry because they'll find out that drugs are killing people and they're not helping anything, and that you can cure these incurable diseases with these variations on fasting. But in the Essene Gospel, that's exactly what they were talking about. They didn't have vegetable juicers, as far as I know, but they had good water. And they used that, and they had enemas because they hollowed out gourds instead of red rubber bags, and they used those, and they made enema bags out of them, and it's explained in detail in that book. And I recommend anybody interested in that should read it. Anyway, that's probably 10 times more than anybody wanted to hear. I tend to say too much sometimes, but getting back in harmony with natural law leads to everything else. And the reason for healing your body, first of all, is just so you don't have to go through hell when you're aging, which I think is a pretty good reason and a good benefit. But that's only the tiniest beginning of the reason. The real one that comes after that is that all of these internal things that are so hard to grasp, you know, we can memorize belief systems. And I'm sure we can see that in our own lives. But grasping something that's beyond words is a bit more challenging. And yet you need to do that because the life force that's keeping you alive is not in English or any other language. It's in its own language. And it's totally readable by the owner of the body, which is you. But you got to get back in touch with it in order to do it. And if you go through the detox and nutrition, physical healing process at your own pace, no pressure. You know, if you're not ready to eat certain better food, don't do it. Because if you do it by force, it'll have a relapse and you won't like it. But once you go through that, the more that you do, you will start understanding things that are not in words way better than you may be able to now. And that's valuable. Because there's this massive force that's coming directly from your source, which there's nothing to be afraid of in it, to say the least. And the more that you can experientially blend with that, there's no limit to what can happen. It's beyond what people call magic, and it's real. So for that reason, I have found that, in my opinion, learning about and going through this process of getting back in touch with natural law and being brave enough to give up cherished habits, not by force, because it doesn't work, but by learning and learning and experimenting until you get so in touch with levels inside yourself that whatever it is you're attached to or addicted to has no hold on you, and you're totally free to do exactly what you consciously choose and not what your habits or your fears dictate. Because at that point, and really at any point, there isn't anything that's worth having any fear about. There's no being to be afraid of, certainly not God to be afraid of, because there's better ways to relate to your source. But there's also no person to be afraid of, and there's no potential event that it's worth being afraid of. And we have to watch our use of language. And I've been the worst, you know, person to do mistakes on this. I was told for years and years and years, well, you might not want to say things that way. This is the opposite of political correctness. It's realizing that when you have focus and you connect it to what you're saying, your words have power. And you really don't want to put them in a negative direction because it doesn't help you or anybody else. So an example of what I'm talking about is if you want to describe a certain thing as scary, that's not an accurate way to describe something because scary comes from you being scared. The thing is not generating the fear. You're generating the fear. You're generating the anger. You're generating the condemnation of other people. You're generating hatred, or you're generating love and acceptance of everybody and wishing well for everybody. That's not coming from the outside. So the truth is, there isn't anything in the world that is scary unless you decide to be scared of it. Because if you decide not to, suddenly it doesn't have the power to be scary anymore. Or if you describe something as frustrating, no, it's what it is. And if you decide to be frustrated by it, then it's frustrating. But it's you. 100% responsibility on our part. And it has to be that way because it also gives you 100% power over your own life. And if you start redirecting and generating goodwill consciously and focused, eventually you find out you can actually direct that toward everybody at once, and it doesn't get diluted. We have that incredible ability. And if you weren't responsible for everything that happens in your life, you also couldn't get the ability to help heal the world. But because you are responsible, nobody else, just you, you also have the power single-handed to unleash so much normalizing and healing energy into the world that there's nothing that can stand in front of it. So I apologize for talking for so long. I probably try to escape, except I'm going to take a couple of people that have been holding. John, are you just listening, or did you want to say something?
Oh, I have a question.
John in Dallas.
Good morning.
Hi.
I basically had a question regarding some of the issues you were having with Whole Foods and their GMO produce. So basically, when it comes to that, is it just their conventional produce that they sell that is GMO, or are you saying that it's possible that some of the foods they're labeling as organic may also be GMO?
No, the reality is since GMO is contaminating the whole world, there are little tiny bits of it everywhere which we can no longer escape. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about what they call conventionally grown produce. And that, even if it's not GMO, if it's so-called conventional, which I think is a very misleading term, that means it's grown with, probably grown with all kinds of pesticides, insecticide, fungicide. And what's just as bad, in my opinion, is chemical fertilizers. And chemical fertilizers were what led to the use of pesticides because they unbalance the soil microorganisms. Then the insects, which have the function of getting rid of inferior plants, move in because they know the plants aren't healthy. And then it becomes obvious that you have to spray them with poison. So if they didn't use the chemical fertilizer and they just kept aware of how to, you know, farm and garden without it, there would be much less indicated need of pesticides. So there's two things I was complaining about. One is for a natural food store that pretends like they care about their customers' health to sell anything grown with poison, which means conventional, is not acceptable. And then, you know, or let's say it's totally unethical at least. And to sell things that are GMO, in addition to that, like fresh corn, if you see fresh corn for sale and it's not organic, it's almost 100% chance it's GMO. And Whole Foods knows all about that. And they're selling fresh corn that's GMO or that's conventional, and I'm sure it's GMO, just so that they can make money from the people who don't know any better than to buy it. That's what I was talking about.
Okay. Yeah, it's one of the, unfortunately, locally, there aren't that many sources of organic produce, so I do go there to shop them. I don't buy their conventional produce. I buy whatever little organic produce they have, so I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, I use Whole Foods, too. I'm a customer there because some of the stuff they have is actually really good.
Right.
And it's hard to find. But yeah. I don't think they'll listen to me, but just in case, I'm letting them know that not all of their customers are happy with the wide selection of poison food.
Right.
I would like, you know, it comes from the top level management that has the conventional business training that whatever is legal that you can make money on is really great.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever you can get away with.
A fellow consumer, do you recommend calling with these kind of concerns, or do you think writing letters is equal, or basically?
I'm not saying that they'll ever pay any attention, but I feel like it's a good thing for us to let them know that we're aware of it, and we would like them to consider changing. And
right.
So yeah, you can, if you go on, you go on a search engine and put in Whole Foods corporate office, or any other big natural food store that is doing the same thing, it'll give you a contact, either email or a phone or both. And in the case of Whole Foods, it gives you both. And so I wrote them an email, and I also called them a couple of times. And I told them, in my case, I would happily give them ideas of how I thought they could make lots of money and not do that. And I don't want to, I'm not asking even to be paid for my time. I just am trying to help them. And if they get any interest in that. The thing is that in most of these huge corporations, they're run by people who totally don't care what happens to anybody as long as they just grow and get more money.
Right.
They're not usually at the level of the really nefarious power structure where they're basically worshiping pain and death and destruction. At the corporate mid-levels in these big corporations, they're just usually completely oblivious of anything except bigger profit and more power.
Mm-hmm.
But just in case, you know, my message reaches even somebody on a switchboard, if they're inside the organization, they might do some good if they were educated. So if you want to help with that, yeah, I'd call them and talk to them like a friend, and don't get mad at them.
Right.
Because if you do, they just become convinced that, you know, people saying this kind of thing are crazy.
Right. No, it's not constructive at all to be, you know, attacking somebody. They just put the wall up and they shut down and they don't hear you. So.
Yeah, just make believe it's your own close friend or family member that you care about working inside the company, and you know that they may not listen to you until much later, but you're planting a seed that at some point they will pay attention to, because every experience, everything we ever hear is saved in our own subconscious. Nothing's lost. And when the receptivity is there, then what you said 20 years ago will have an effect.
Well, I think it's good timing, because I know that they've been reporting in the news that thanks to stores like Sprouts and Trader Joe's being competitors, that Whole Foods has seen the difference financially. They've seen drops in sales and a loss in consumer base to these other competitors. So maybe this is the right time, where they're basically seeing that the market is changing and that people are...
It could be, yeah. And you know, we don't... It's not really up to us what their personal speed of evolution of consciousness might be. But if they can just understand that the market is changing more, and there's some great people working on this, like Dr. Mercola, Dr. Bronner's company they're working on it with things like trying to at least label GMO foods, which obviously should be banned, but labeling them is better than having them just unknown to people. And if they just know, Jeffrey Smith is another... He's one of the greatest educators on GMOs, for example. His books are excellent, and so are his videos. And they can be shared with other people, too, especially ones that want to know the scientific information. Just get Jeffrey Smith's books and videos on GMOs. And what they're saying is that if you change the consumer market and more people just don't buy that stuff, you don't have to wait for the companies to become ethical. They'll just change because they can't sell the bad stuff anymore.
Right, right.
So, yeah, I think that's a great service, anybody who wants to help with that.
Yeah, I like that idea. And another question I had is, when you were talking about the process of converting from packaged and processed foods to raw, I know in my past when I did that many years ago, that there is a cleansing and a detox of the different chemicals that get stored in the body that aren't natural, that are used as food preservatives or other chemicals used in harvesting these foods. And I was wondering if there were any particular herbs or other nutrients, maybe like this mineral source water you're talking about, or some kind of supplements that kind of help the body to remove these things in a much more efficient manner, so they don't basically cause trouble as they're loosened up from wherever they were buried or stored And on their way out of the body, sometimes they can cause trouble. So everything just kind of helps support the detox process. Kind of like in the Gerson Clinic, they used to use, raw calf liver extract, which, of course, is not probably something that everyone wants to try using. So if there were other alternatives to basically things that nutrients that would help the body to, you know, remove these toxins.
Yeah, I think the one of the good things about the cod liver oil that Gerson was using was the fat content, the saturated fat. And really, I think raw milk is the best source of that. But during a cleansing, when you're actually like on a juice fast or something like that, I think by far the most powerful aid to not cause too much trouble is water. You don't need to drink very much water if you're on a juice fast because you're not going to be very thirsty. But the enemas are indispensable. And I would make sure not to use chlorinated or fluoridated water for enemas. And the way that that helps with the detox, making it more comfortable and less damaging, is that the body is instantly aware of the condition of the gut when it's cleansing. So if you stop eating and it starts bringing out old deposits that were stored in the cells, and the gut is lined with old garbage on the intestinal walls and stuff, it can't dump it into the gut very well at all. So it keeps recirculating it. Some of it gets reabsorbed in the bloodstream, and you can get some really bad symptoms from that. Not as much on a juice fast as during a water fast, which is the most serious. But, you know, the juice fast has a lot of buffering chemicals in itself, in the juice, which are in much better form than a dried powder of any kind. And so one of the reasons that the juice fast is easier and more like what you're talking about is that you're getting not only nutrients, but buffering chemicals of different kinds in a natural form that are in the juice. So as far as what to take in, I would say the juice is the main thing. But in addition to that, keeping the gut as cleaned out as possible with the enemas, using those correctly. And Marcus has a really good video about that online as well, on YouTube. This has a massive change in the degree of discomfort that's experienced during cleansing. And that's why, in fact, when Gerson figured out how powerful that was, the cancer patients that were being killed by painkillers because they were in so much distress, even while they were trying, you know, not eating, he found that with them, the enemas had to be really frequent. And if they were frequent enough, they could throw away all the painkillers. So I think between drinking the juice, vegetable juice, not fruit, because that mixes with toxins in a bad way, but vegetable juice during that kind of a program, and the water enemas, I think that is way more powerful than anything else I know to use, especially in dry powder form.
Excellent.
Yeah,
and,
hopefully that's helpful.
Further into the raw diet, and basically trying to make sure that we have proteins and carbohydrates and fats, you know, that the body needs for its different functions. Mm-hmm. Is there a place in the future? I mean, now you were discussing basically how grains, of course, they need to be freshly ground and used quickly because they begin to oxidize and break down, and they're not then that life force leaves. Is it the same thing with oils then? Is there really a place, or there's not a place in a raw diet then for oils like olive oil or even maybe ghee? I mean, is there a place for like unheated ghee or olive oil in just a raw diet?
Well, for one thing, ghee is not a raw food. It's extremely cooked. And
right.
It comes from a heat process of separating out parts of butter from each other. So, you know, if it's natural, it doesn't have anything bad in it, but it's got no life force at all. It's totally dead. And as far as other oils go, they're pretty much in the same category, although they may not be subjected to heat. You know, if olive oil is cold pressed, then at least it's not corrupted by heat. But I think that you get to a point where you really don't want oils anymore. And you're getting the oil in the live form with nuts and seeds or in the form of fat in the raw milk. And at that point, there just isn't a need for oil. It may be raw, but it's not live. So it's right. kind of a transition class of foods that it can help when you're having really good salads, you know, that are helping you not want cooked potatoes all the time and stuff like that. Olive oil and coconut oil can be really useful. Some of the other seed oils are really questionable, and those seem to be the two that have the least drawbacks. But ultimately, you end up not needing them after a while.
Okay, so the fats that the body needs can come from avocado, can come from walnut, those kind of foods.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And I really found that I haven't found any way to make it completely stable in the long term with strictly vegan sources. I mean, the long-term raw vegans usually try to make that work with extensive supplementation. I don't know any of them that are raw vegans without a lot of supplements. And I guess I've just found that if it can be found, the raw milk is the best supplement that I've run into. And it happens to be a live food. And it happens to be full of life force. And it's got the kind of saturated fat that give you the foundation for all the hormones that you absolutely have to have. And I think, you know, Matt Monarch has talked a lot about the psychological instability that happens to most raw vegans, in addition to getting emaciated and things like that. And as far as I can tell, the raw milk totally eliminates that almost overnight.
Wow.
It's really quite amazing. And because they're so religiously devoted to the label of vegan, and they have all these studies that show how terrible milk is, you know, association with osteoporosis and cancer and heart disease. Those studies, all the ones I've looked at, I wouldn't call it milk at all. That's the pasteurized poison stuff that you buy in the store. And of course, that creates a lot of disease, but it has no relation to actual raw milk the right way.
Okay. So. Perfect. Awesome. I really appreciate all that. And I was also, lastly, hoping, is there any way maybe on your main page, if you could set up one of those Amazon links that we talked about before to maybe some of the esteemed books that were available? That way people...
Yeah, it's a good idea. I really need to do that. And I'm sure Doug is listening. He can write it down and see if there's a way we can do that, because... there's a lot of good books. We could do something like have, you know, the Essene books listed there, and then any other good references that people could look at. Like, for example, I really like Marcus Rothgren's book, Heal Yourself 101. He doesn't, you know, he's raw vegan, but the basic principles of cleansing, detox, live food, making it enjoyable, you know, how the cleansing works, all that. He's really inspiring. Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
No, it's awesome.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so we could do that, and there's a bunch of other ones that I would put in there. So we'll try to put that on the to-do list and get to it as quickly as we can.
No worries. I just thought it'd be great. That way it's a good source of revenue for the website and for the work that you're doing, so that we all appreciate.
Yeah, that would really help. So I think it's a good idea, and everybody would benefit. So thanks for the idea.
All right, well, thank you very much, Richard, for your time, and you too, Doug, and I hope the two of you enjoy a great weekend.
Okay, you too, John. Talk to you soon.
Okay.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, and Dee has been holding for a while, so let's see what she has to say. Hi, Dee. Were you listening, or did you have things to talk about?
Hi, Richard. Yeah, I had some things I wanted to mention, and you covered everything really very thoroughly today, and appreciate that. And also John's input was nice. I I was trying to feed my chicken some organic layer scratch, and they won't eat it. Like, I've tried four different kinds. First, I tried the Purina organic. They totally wouldn't. Well, no, actually, they liked that, and then.
Oh, okay.
But that was soy and corn, and so I was going to some more private milling companies to try to find something they could eat that, because if I don't have that much space to free range them all the time.
Sure.
And I found one that's totally really good looking on the label. It had really natural ingredients, a lot of herbs, and diatomaceous earth, and it was supposed to be organic alfalfa, organic corn, and organic soy, organic wheat.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't really like that one. And then I found one that had no soy at all, but it had organic corn. But they don't like any of them really that much.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I mean, I have had chickens before, and they're really great. I like chickens a lot, not to eat, but as actual beings. And they get really friendly if they like you, and they'll jump into your hands to be patted and stuff like that. But I would trust their judgment with feed, and I just keep trying different ones until you find a good one, because if you get one that's really good and clean and truly organic and it's got what they need, it does make them healthier, and they lay more eggs, and they're larger eggs, and everything, their eyes look better. I mean, everything improves if you can find one that's really good. And then, but still give them a lot of fresh green stuff and vegetable scraps to eat, as well as a place outside where they can dig up bugs and that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's what they like the best, is the bugs. They don't even eat that much. They won't eat greens if I pick them and throw them in there. They only eat them if they get to go pick them themselves. So I guess they really like them fresh.
Yeah, I would really go with their judgment first. And as long as it's, I mean, they don't have judgment about things that are unnaturally dangerous, that are some toxic chemical that's not in the database they were given. But as far as normal choices of what they want to eat and stuff like that, I would let them make the choice. If they don't want any grain, that's fine. They don't have to have it.
Yeah, so then I thought, well, what about more natural stuff like what birds eat, like Milo and millet and that kind of thing?
Yeah.
So that's called scratch, I guess, chicken scratch. So I found an organic chicken scratch that has, you know, the little round seeds. And they kind of like that, but not a whole lot. They'll eat some of it. And then it
They don't have to eat huge amounts of it either. You could just have some available for when they want it.
Right. And then it comes with these sunflower seeds that have the black shell on them. They can't eat that at all, so they totally waste those. But I decided to give them some cracked sunflower seeds that I had that I eat.
Yeah.
They're organic sunflower seeds.
Okay.
And they love them. They're like just chicken crack cocaine. They can't get enough of them.
Now, do those have shells or not?
Not. They don't like the ones with the shells.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I just watch them and make sure they don't OD on them, because in nature they have to shell each one, you know, which slows it down. But if they're not eating them so fast that it makes them sick or something, it could be fine.
Yeah, so I mean, I think I might just go with the sunflower seeds and the bugs and let them pick their own stuff.
Yeah, and you just, you know, you do the same you do with your own body. You just observe really carefully. And as long as they're feeling really great and energetic and they don't get sick and anything, that's a good sign.
Yeah, so yeah, I'm enjoying the chickens, and I do like the eggs. And I noticed if they are eating even the organic corn and soy, if they do eat some of it, you know, and then I eat their eggs, I will feel it. I will get sick.
You'll get sick, you said?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a reaction to corn and soy, so I don't.
Okay.
I can't even eat their eggs if they're eating corn and soy.
Okay.
Even if it's
so that
organic.
That makes it simple deciding about that.
Yeah. So. So if they're just free-ranging, like I did an experiment and didn't give them anything for like a week and let them just eat bugs and grass, I had no problem with those eggs at all.
Good. They need to have some, you know, grass type or greens or vegetables or something. So if they're getting some grass, that's really good. And,
yeah, I mean, I thought I was just allergic to eggs, but it wasn't that. It was I was allergic to what the chickens that were laying the eggs were eating.
Yeah, everything is so porous, you know, what goes through the plant, the soil and the plants and the animals and gets into us, everything affects everything. And everything is connected. So it's not just if it's recognized in a book. Something that is normally not thought to have any contact at all has a direct connection. And it's just a challenge for observation to figure it out.
So, yeah, I'm looking at the eggs and the milk kind of the same way, where it's not eating an animal. It's not taking the animal off of the universe or planet.
No.
It's just using a byproduct or what they're producing for life. I mean, it's living.
Chickens don't mind sharing their eggs. I mean, when I was eating cooked food quite a long time ago, I had chickens and was trying to be natural. And I found out for myself, no, they're not stressed by you taking the eggs as long as you're not coming in, throwing them out of the nesting box, you know, and intruding. If you take some of the eggs while they're out eating, they don't mind at all. And in fact, if one gets broken and you can't collect it, they will voraciously eat it themselves. So it's not like CPS coming and taking your kid.
Right. And, well, my chickens don't have a rooster, so they're not fertile eggs anyways. I'm not eating a lot at all.
Right. So if somebody was objecting that there is a baby chicken that's a couple days old or something just forming, that's not true with your chickens because they're just females.
Right. And I don't, I think it's just like a placenta. It's just it's a power-packed, nutrient-dense little bag inside that.
You're not killing anybody when you're doing that.
Right.
So,
and
I
then
don't
I had a comment about the lactose intolerance.
Right.
Because I have a really bad lactose intolerance, and even when I was doing the raw milk for quite a while, I could not adjust to overcoming it. Of course, I'm really enzyme deficient anyways, which probably has a lot to do with that. But I don't have an appendix, and that's where the enzyme little factory and proby factories are. And so I'm thinking
It's too bad that people do things like that to us, you know, removing organs and telling us, well, that's just an extra organ, you don't need it. But you have to find the best ways to compensate that you possibly can. You can use other fermented food, as I think you've mentioned before. And also, any kind of deficiency is always worth checking, in my experience, for deficiencies in different kinds of trace minerals that may be needed to bring back the production of certain other materials in the body. And the Himalayan salt is a really good source of about 85 different trace minerals. I find that extremely beneficial for everybody I know of that's ever used it. And I'm going to be looking at this other mineral source because it comes from a liquid mineral source because it comes from an ancient, basically humic and fulvic acid deposit in Utah from old plant residue, millions and millions of years old. And they're not feeding you the old decayed plant residue. They're putting that in water, letting it leach into the water, the good elements, and then using the water as the supplement. And I don't know personally until I work with it whether it's good or not, but if it is, that's the kind of thing I would do to try to compensate, you know, with trace minerals and other types of fermented food until I eventually got to the point where I could use the milk. And if not, I would try a smaller and smaller and smaller amount until it doesn't bother you.
Well, I did find a workaround, and that was to gently, with very low heat, to culture the milk. And I have no lactose intolerance whatsoever.
Okay, good.
I can do the curds, and I can do the whey right after the curds or right before it. And even though they're both in my stomach at the same time, it does not cause a lactose intolerance.
Okay.
Because
then
they've already converted. Yeah, they already converted.
Yeah, because you're getting all of the original elements in the milk by doing that, and I can't see anything wrong with it. You're not heat destroying it. You know, you're not doing the usual yogurt process, which is 180 Fahrenheit. You're doing just a little bit of heat, and I think you got an ideal answer.
I just wanted to say there is ways around it for people that do have lactose intolerance that they can't seem to get over because maybe there's a reason for that, like missing.
That's a brilliant solution. So I would say, and that's one that's available instantly to anybody, and they just have to learn how to make the cultured product without heat.
Yeah, and I'm going to send you that recipe, and it's really not that hard. It's a little learning curve, but not bad.
Okay, yeah, we'll post it on the website.
And then on the...
that's valuable.
The liquid minerals, I did one like that, but instead of Himalayan or fulvic, it was using sea salt, Celtic sea salt.
Yeah.
And so you put half a quart jar full of all your sea salt, and then you put the water in there and you keep adding salt and stirring it until it...
Okay,
all...
you're using the water as a supplement.
Yeah, and it's called Soleil. So you take the water off the top after the water's totally saturated by melted Celtic salt.
Yeah, and it's all the solid salt is settled on the bottom.
Yeah.
Right.
And
yeah.
I didn't, after I heard how to make it, I made it and I tried it, but I didn't catch part where they were saying you're supposed to put the teaspoon of Soleil into more pure water before you drink it, and I was
It just tastes too salty if you don't do that.
Yeah, so I was doing it wrong, but
okay. Well, remember too that Himalayan salt is sea salt, but it's just from a different time frame.
Right.
You know, the Celtic sea salt is probably coming in the North Atlantic from one of the best remaining places on the planet. That's not as polluted, but the Himalayan salt comes out of oceans that were many millions of years ago. And so as far as we know, they were clean. And it's just a way to avoid the ocean pollution is all.
Right, because we've got a lot of that now. But I heard another person on another radio show talking about how they're trying to do it in olive oil to, like, use the oil as a carrier for the minerals that leaches from the salt.
Mm-hmm. You could do that, but like we were talking about with John, I think eventually you get to where you want less and less oil.
Right, because it goes rancid really fast, too.
Yeah, it does, and I don't think it's a live food product.
Okay, there's...
Even though it's not heated. You know, it's fine for, like, a transition and to make salads taste good and stuff like that. But eventually, I think that you get to a place where you don't need it.
Okay. Well, also, you were talking about minerals and things, little things like vitamins and minerals. Like, what I've learned is that vitamins and enzymes are cofactors to help carry the minerals to where they need to go to get them in the cell. They're not just a hard, you know, mineral. They're actually being transferred or catalyzed into a usable form of a mineral. And so if we don't have all of our cofactors, which are the vitamins and the enzymes, that transfer doesn't really happen very well, and then we get deficient in certain items that our cells need in order to like detoxify and make things work right.
Mm-hmm.
So I personally have found something that's really helping me. Apparently, I got finally a test for the MTHFR, and I was showing positive.
Say that again. I didn't follow what you were saying. Say it again.
Oh, I finally got a test for MTHFR. It's a gene mutation that the body has, like what the doctors that were looking into the autism and things, they were discovering that a lot of these children had this gene mutation called MTHFR.
Uh-huh.
That's the doctors that came up with the GCMAF to help the kids to get over that problem.
Right.
So what it turns out, you know, what it is basically is a cobalt's a mineral, or you could call it a metal. Minerals are metals, basically, that doesn't convert properly because of a gene mutation. And like you said before, genes can get switched on and off. It doesn't mean if you're born with the propensity toward it that it's going to happen to you. It just means that you have more of a propensity for that to happen easier.
Mm-hmm.
And so what's going on with the chemtrails in what I've been looking at is that there's a lot of aluminum, like you've pointed out, and Russ Tanner's pointed out, and Dane Wigington, that the methyl aluminum is a form of aluminum that goes past the blood-brain barrier directly into the brain.
Mm-hmm.
And so what that methyl, you know how iodine works to, because it's a halide, but it's a heavier halide than the fluoride and the chloride and the bromide, and it helps to knock those bad halogens off of the receptors so that
yeah.
the thyroid hormone can get in there and stuff. Well, I think it's the same way with the methyl aluminum. It's blocking the receptors for things like vitamin B12, cobalt, those kind of usable
mm-hmm.
methylated metals. Because it's a methyl aluminum, but we need the methyl cobalamin, and we need forms of vitamins that we can assimilate that carries those trace minerals into the cells. So with these people like me that have a MTHFR gene mutation, it's actually blocking or lacking a way to get the B12 usable in a usable form. So
okay.
They have added a CH3 group, which is one carbon and three hydrogen molecules. So they call this supplement a methylated B12, and it's just a sublingual tablet that you
mm-hmm.
put under your tongue. And so what that methylated B12 and methylfolate, which is methylated B9,
mm-hmm.
Some people don't have a B9 problem, but a lot of people with a B12 problem also have a B9 problem. So those two methylated supplements of the B vitamins change everything. They make it so a person who normally is not receiving that kind of nutrient can receive it, and therefore they can actually make their vitamin D in their body.
So have you been doing that?
Yeah, it's like a whole night and day difference in me, and I just realized that's probably part of my whole conversion that I've been going through is probably a lot because of that.
Well, that's really interesting. The other thing is that all of the B vitamins that you're talking about getting in that form are also in the fermented kefir stuff that you're making, and I'm thinking that it's possible that once you're on the methylated forms for a while, the natural form in that fermented kefir might be able to take over.
Right.
So something I would watch for.
No, I like that. I like that input because I believe in jump starting stuff. Because like when did the bath that you recommended, it did something. It jump started.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And sometimes that's all it needs. And then a natural form that doesn't leave you dependent on the supplement anymore can work fine.
Right. You just need to get a jolt to get going on it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like on the other side, that's a danger in some of the unnatural forms of hormones that people take. And it shuts down the body's production of what little it can make and makes
right.
them more dependent than before. So if you can do the opposite using a natural form, remind the body of what it's capable of, sometimes it'll just take over.
Right. And sometimes it'll correct the gene mutation by switching the histones back on or off, and then the DNA can actually sequence properly.
Yeah, I mean it's been demonstrated that the body's capable, or the energy in the body is capable of correcting almost anything, because remember I mentioned Arkady Petrov in Russia, and they're working with organ regeneration and showing that in certain cases the body is capable of doing things like regenerating a removed gallbladder. Stuff
wow.
that people
wow.
would never imagine it could be true. But it's not a theory, it's already been done. So what they're trying to do is narrow down what made it possible in certain people for that to happen so that everybody can use it. And they're still in early stages of research, but they've gotten to the point where it's been demonstrated with a gallbladder, with teeth that were completely gone, other organs and parts of the body. It's enough at this point to show that there is a way to repair or regenerate just about any part of the body if you can tune into the secrets of doing it, and that's what we're looking for.
That's so neat. I was thinking about the vocabulary word manifest, and so I actually looked it up in the dictionary, and I think that's how God or spirit or, you know, the power, the source, life, source, force works, is not just some invisible place we want to get to, but it's right here, right now, in a visible form, which is like our bodies.
Yeah. Well, after a while, it becomes obvious that to separate out that spirit or what you want to call spiritual from other things is a misunderstanding.
Right.
And once you get to that, you start looking for meaning in everything, that it's not just a bunch of coincidences happening in your life, but you're being offered clues and lessons in absolutely every little thing that happens. And a lot of indigenous people around the world have understood that. And, you know, we get little tiny reports of it, like they see an eagle fly in a certain direction and they say, oh, well, that means this or that. It's not just which direction an eagle flies, it's everything that comes up. And if once you learn to start reading that, not from some memorized translation list, but from what you discover in your own inner exploration, you start feeling like you're being talked to all the time in the form of events. And it gets really interesting.
So the cravings for grain is just gone. I mean,
hear you. The craving for what?
Cravings for like rice. I was really craving rice. Rice.
So what do you think took that away?
The B vitamin deficiency of the B12 and the B9.
Okay, that's really interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just gone. And I think I jump-started it with the fasting.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
It just blossomed and turning my mind around. So now everything that, like you say, every moment of every day when stuff comes up, I look at it, recognize it, and turn it to the right direction immediately.
Oh, good. That's the most powerful thing, is the non-physical part.
Yeah, the forgiveness part is just unbelievable. It's just it's great.
And that thing we talked about earlier about loving your neighbor as yourself, you know, one way to see that, even though it's been through a lot of translations and changes, no doubt, it's got truth in it. And it also could be seen as you cannot love your neighbor any differently than you love yourself or any more.
I like that, because we're not bad people. I mean, we do bad things, but so there's a difference between the person and the action. So we have to separate out that person is,
I mean,
not
a good parent doesn't just kill their baby because they're not already learning everything. They have to have some patience. And it's like on one level, we're the parent over our own personality and body and where it's gotten to so far with all its programming and everything. We got to have some patience and be like a good parent and not just, you know, beat up the kid. That's not the way to do it.
And if the kid's got a problem, it's probably our fault anyways, because they imprint everything within the first year of life anyway.
Yeah, exactly. They trust us. And the same happens with the body. It's developed along the lines we've allowed it to go.
Yeah. So, I mean, this whole ride has been just, I always wanted to change. I never knew how to do it. I always knew I wanted to not fight cravings, but just get over them easily.
Yeah.
This is really working out neat. I am so
good.
Excited.
I'm really happy to hear that. In a way, we're all of us who are working to find out whatever is true and whatever works and whatever is positive. We are a research team that's all operating independently, each one of us, and sharing what we observe. And, you know, cooperating, we can learn things a lot faster than everybody being isolated.
Yeah. So I was listening to a YouTube, and this guy's name is Benjamin Lynch, L-Y-N-C-H, and there's a YouTube that explains it really, really well. I don't know if I have the title anywhere, but he just explains that whole methylation thing, and I think that's what the chemtrails are mostly doing. So he's saying in that YouTube that probably about 30% of certain ethnicities are having this gene mutation switched because they have a propensity. And then the methyl aluminum in the chemtrails is making that switch. So there's like massive amounts of people that are having this B12 and B9 deficiency problem right now.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And it's probably not an oversight. My guess is that it's an intentional design of the chemtrail recipes.
Right.
That they know it'll cause that problem, so they make it that way. And there's probably hundreds of other things like that that are operating too. And because of that, in a way, what we're all looking for is how do you get levels of immunity that we were always taught were not possible?
Right.
So that these things bounce off of us. And even if they're still happening and we haven't quite managed to get the spraying stopped, while we're still working on it, how do we become impervious to the effects?
Yeah, and he's saying the same thing that you're saying about the laws of nature, and you got to get the basics first before you try to add the things that are missing, because once you add them, things just start detoxing, and if you're not ready to handle that detox load, it'll be not very pleasant.
So yeah, send me an email about it with any contact information for him that you might have. And I really like this model of a loose-knit team of independent researchers, which we all are, anybody that wants to get into exploring these things. And the main requirement is you have to be willing to observe what happens when you do things. And if we are doing that without anything to defend, we just want to know what's really happening, then we can all progress exponentially faster than if we're trying to all do it alone.
That's so neat. I think it is a progression. Like, first I was doing certain things, and then I heard about the fasting from you, and then, you know, I was doing the raw cheese or whatever, and all these things added up. I was doing the iodine. I was getting, you know, those receptors cleaned off. I was doing all these different things. And so this is like the cherry on top of the cake now. And so I'm starting to feel things like, you know, when you're a kid and you're out on a spring day and you just feel really so good, you want to just be on the top of a mountain shouting or something?
Yeah, yeah.
You're feeling like glimpses.
Yeah, and a lot of great spiritual teachers have said to become like little kids. And there's a lot in that. And when you look at, all right, what is keeping me from being like a little kid? Certainly one of the things, if you can reverse the degeneration of your body, that helps a lot. Because if you physically feel more energetic and your joints are more flexible and stuff, then you're going to naturally get more into that mindset of the youthful energy. But the other thing I've found recently, because I'm really looking at this subject about, all right, that sounds very nice, become like little children. You know, you can repeat it to other people. You can memorize it yourself. That's not as good as doing it, right? All these beliefs that have truth in them, it's better to actually do them. So, I thought, what is it besides doing all this important detox, fasting, live food, organic, stuff like that, good attitude, good positive feeling toward everybody, which normal kids tend to have, what else? And if this is, you know, in progress, so I'm not able to describe it really perfectly, but you stand in a mirror and look at your face. Everything in your life experience is recorded in your face. It's actually recorded in every part of your body, but your face is easy to see it in. You've got, you know, different feel of the tissue, different lines that are forming and stuff like that. If you could decode that, it would go back to the whole story of your existence. So if you start focusing on that, really tune into it, drop the resistance, drop fear, you know, drop fear from everything. It's just totally not helpful. And start having the intent, just like you had the intent to wish well for other people. Have the intent for the stress and the damage and the emotional trauma and bad experiences in your life represented by these minute lines or obvious lines that form in your face, to have them go away, not just the lines in a dermatological sense, but what they actually came from and what they represent, and letting that go and see what happens. And I'm just starting to dig into that.
That's way cool. So the mirror, I like the mirror thing. When I was a kid, I always thought I was on the other side, what belonged on the other side of the mirror. It was just a really weird thing with me. I don't
yeah.
know what it was. But so well, wishing well and well wishing are mirror images of each other.
Yeah, and you have to do it for yourself or you're going to be a fake doing it for other people.
Uh-huh. Also, I like your little thing about antidotes, like, you know, the golden rule and whatnot, but there's other ones like it's not whether you win or lose, it's how you play the game. All those are really interesting things.
Yeah, they're interesting old sayings, and they have all kinds of different origins. You know, Ring Around the Rosie was a game that came out of the plague in England. And all kinds of interesting stuff. They're not all super positive, but they all have interesting histories.
Yeah.
But, you know, we can make up our own, too.
There you go. I like it. Well, thanks so much. I just wanted to say that it's just a transformation that, like, coming out from death to life, like out of a cocoon and turning into a butterfly experience. And I didn't even know it was possible on this side. I thought you had to die to do that, but I was...
Yeah, no, it's actually much better if you don't die first. And, you know,
yeah.
when you're... There's something about operating in a very hostile, difficult environment, which physical level experience is, that whatever you learn while you're still here has this massive power in it because you did it in the most difficult circumstances. And so it becomes really deeply learned lesson.
Interesting.
So, yeah, there was something else you brought up just now that I was trying to think what I was going to say about that.
Well, the morphing.
Oh, I know what it was. You were just saying why you feel like you had this big transformation from a level of being dead to more alive.
Right.
And I'm just suggesting, whenever that happens, hopefully a lot, that one thing you can do as an exercise is recalibrate how you're looking at it. You know, in your initial experience is, wow, I've just come to a much more full experience of my existence, or I feel a lot better, or more energetic, or I feel healthier, or happier, or better towards other people, or whatever it is, recalibrate that to zero. Meaning, now that's normal, and what you want to start scanning for and looking for is an equal jump above that. Like, what if I feel now is not this fantastic thing that I'm just getting used to? What if I call that my baseline normal? And I know that above that, just like my last step, there's another one of exhilaration that is already there, and I just have to start feeling where it is.
Wow, this is like learning how to walk all over again.
Yeah, and that goes on for many, many, many steps. So that's what I was trying to refer to when I was saying you don't need drug highs.
Mm-hmm.
They're like nothing. They're negative. They're counterproductive and suicidal. And it doesn't mean you're bad for looking for them, because there's an innate desire of every person that comes from a good place to feel really good, because part of you knows that that's your normal state. You came from a place that is way beyond feeling as good as you can imagine. So we know that's there, and we look for it first in the easy ways, you know, and people look for it through a chemical drug or through something that tastes good, you just eat a million pounds of it trying to feel even better, or which doesn't work, obviously. And or you, in some confused ways, people try to get that feeling by putting down other people or thinking how bad they are or thinking critically or condemning of somebody. It's all an attempt to feel good, some more confused than others. And if you find it internally, like what you're talking about, the other ones can't even interest you. You don't need any willpower to stay away from
the laws of nature. We're getting there by the right path instead of the wrong path. So actually,
yeah,
you get a lot different. We end up in a different place.
Yeah, you end up closer and closer to your how you normally are supposed to be.
Which
it's
nobody
not something
really
you
has an idea of what that feels like.
Only the people who have gotten there, and there are some of those. But for most of us, no, we don't have the slightest clue. We're not even close. But we do know that it's not something you have to construct or you have to work really hard to do. Your hard work is to stop blocking it, because the normal state is what tries to come through you all the time.
That's so neat. I mean, our bodies are designed to do that. So if we have the right key to the lock, so to speak, the receptors can be opened to the right things instead of blocked by the wrong things.
Yeah, exactly right.
That's exciting.
So, we'll see what happens next.
Okay, well, thank you so much again.
Okay, have a good rest of the weekend.
You too.
All right, talk to you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Okay, so as Doug fortunately just reminded me, we're just about out of time, and we have about a little less than 4 minutes. And I just really want to thank everybody who's listening, not just live, but also even to pieces of the archive. Thanks for sharing it with us. And like Dee and John, everybody has brought out, we're all independent members of a research team. And contrary to what our leaders would like us to think, we're actually not here to fight with each other. We're here to cooperate, realize that everybody's making an amazing, unique contribution, and just to become good observers, to wake up again enough to do that, and especially internally, because if you forget about what's going on inside you, and you just watch what's going on in terms of other people around you, what they're doing, and circumstances, you miss 99% of what's important, which is all happening inside of you. The paradox, apparently, is that if you turn towards what's happening internally, then whatever you do on the outside becomes really powerful and has much better positive results. Doesn't just, you know, evolve into hating the people who disagree with you and, you know, wanting to kill all the bad people and stuff like that, which doesn't go to a good place. You get to where you can contribute something massive to the fate and the well-being of the rest of the world. So I just really want to thank and encourage everybody who's already doing that. I'm just kind of getting to come along for the ride on this show. You guys are what is where the main activity and benefit actually is. And I'm just reminding you of how amazingly valuable your contribution is, and wherever you are is the exact right place with the exact right people to do it. And consider every one of those circumstances and people a gift, even if they're positive, even if they're difficult, and see what they're offering you to learn. So have a great week. We'll see you next time. Thanks for being with us, and look forward to talking to you again. Be with us tomorrow night too, if you can, on the show on Sunday evening. Talk to you next time.